Okay, colleagues, the next item of business is consideration of business motion 4969 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a timetable for the State's reconsideration of the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press the request to speak button, and I call on George Adam to move the motion. Mr Adam.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Minister. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 4969 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Thank you very much. The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is Stage 3 Proceedings of the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill. In dealing with the amendments, members should have the bill as amended at Stage 2, that's SP Bill 4A, the marshalled list and the groupings of amendments. The division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the Stage 3. The period of voting for each division will be up to 1 minute. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press the request to speak buttons as soon as possible after I call the group. Given the fact that the Cabinet Secretary will be participating remotely, it has been agreed at Bureau earlier this morning that if members who have already spoken in the debate wish to make a further contribution after the Cabinet Secretary has spoken, I will consider allowing that, and I would invite you in those circumstances to press your request to speak buttons at that point, and we will go back to the Cabinet Secretary thereafter. Members should now refer to the marshalled list of amendments. And we start with Group 1 on purpose. I call Amendment 15 in the name of Rhoda Grant, grouped with Amendment 16. Rhoda Grant to move Amendment 15 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move Amendment 15 and speak to others in the group. It appears to me strange that the Scottish Government chooses to legislate but refuses to spell out on the face of the bill what the purposes of that legislation is. A purpose clause would provide clarity on the Government's vision for implementing the legislation. We believe that a Good Food Nation bill must give effect to our human right to food, and I believe the Cabinet Secretary does as well. To quote her, "It is the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill that will put in place the long-term planning that is necessary to make both the practical and cultural changes that we need to make human rights around food a reality for everyone in Scotland." I welcome that commitment. This amendment seeks to put that aim and purpose on the face of the bill. The bill has the potential to be world-leading in its approach. At Stage 2, the Government rejected a similar amendment, saying that it had no force in law. Therefore, this new amendment clarifies that by stating that regard should be had to that purpose when preparing and implementing Good Food Nation plans. The Scottish Government have committed to enshrine our human rights into Scots law, and this is a welcome step. Therefore, I cannot understand why they would refuse to state clearly in this legislation that the purpose is to implement our human right to food. As part of our ratification on international treaties, we already have the right to food, but despite that, we have a growing problem with hunger and malnutrition, which we must address. If we do not implement that right to food, we store up problems for the future. The cost is poor health and the resurfacing of diseases due to malnutrition. Hunger also impacts on younger generations. It's impossible to learn on an empty stomach, and I welcome moves towards free school meals and policies that address holiday hunger. However, these policies are simply sticking plasters on a problem. To deal with hunger, we need to deal with the root causes and allow every family to be able to feed their own children. The inability to do that is inhumane and soul-destroying. With this bill, we have an opportunity to put policies in train that deal with this, and I urge members to support the amendment. I also support Amendment 16 in the name of Rachel Hamilton. It provides a detailed submission on what the bill should do, and none of these points contradict the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Ms Grant. I now call Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 16 and the other amendment in the group. Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Without ensuring a Good Food Nation plan has a clearly defined purpose, it is unreasonable to expect the aims of the bill can be met. Amendment 16, which I move in my name, defines the purpose of a Good Food Nation plan in a manner that matches the ambition the Scottish Government has for this bill. Plans should, of course, work for producers, purveyors and consumers, but they also need to work for the environment. The inclusion of these points in my amendment are strongly supported by WWF and NFUS. The need to ensure those tasked with implementing plans are guided by a clear purpose has been highlighted by the Scottish Food Coalition throughout the passage of this bill. My amendment seeks to address this need and offers succinct and substantive guidance on this matter that would help fulfil the aims of the bill. Commenting on Rhoda Grant's amendments on the human right to food, whilst the Scottish Conservatives are of the opinion that this could be covered in the Scottish Government's human rights bill, we absolutely understand concerns and reservations about the Scottish Government's pledge to deliver this bill anytime soon. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. I now call Arianne Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As we agreed at stage two when this bill was before the committee, this is an important right that we want to see embedded in Scots law. However, the most appropriate way to do that is through the Human Rights Scotland Bill, where the right to food will be incorporated alongside other international treaties and ensure that they have legal effect. I also note that the bill, as amended at stage two, includes provision for ministers to have regard to a number of international instruments in relation to the right to food when preparing their Good Food Nation plan. This will ensure that due attention is given to the right to food until the Human Rights Scotland Bill is passed. And for these reasons, I will not be supporting Rhoda Grant's Amendment 15. On Amendment 16 from Rachel Hamilton, the amendment as drafted does not specify Scottish ministers or relevant authorities, and so it's unclear where the responsibility for this would lie. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to respond. Cabinet Secretary.
Amendment 15 would insert wording stating that the purpose of the bill is to give effect to the human right to food through Good Food Nation plans, and that regard should be had to this purpose when preparing and implementing Good Food Nation plans. But the member did lodge a similar amendment in relation to a purpose provision about the right to food at stage two, and I didn't support the amendment because it didn't have a clear legal effect. Amendment 15 does have a legal effect in that it sets out a duty that regard should be had to the purpose in preparing and implementing Good Food Nation plans. However, I do have other concerns about this amendment. It has the effect that the right to food is the sole focus of the legislation, which isn't the intention. This bill is intended to cover the whole of the wide-ranging nature of the Good Food Nation vision and not to focus on one particular specific aspect of food policy. And furthermore, it's not clear what this amendment would add to the provisions in relation to the right to adequate food that are already in the bill, though, for example, in sections 1A on principles and 3 on consideration of international instruments. We've also committed to incorporating human rights treaties into domestic law with a human rights bill introduced in this parliamentary term. The human rights bill will give effect to a wide range of internationally recognised human rights in Scots law as far as possible within devolved competence, including the right to adequate food as part of the overall right to an adequate standard of living. The Human Rights Bill is the appropriate place to address these complex interrelationships between the rights and obligations across 4 treaties in a single, coherent and integrated framework. And it's for these reasons that I would ask members not to support Amendment 15 in Rhoda Grant's name. Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 16 also sets out a purpose provision. And my view is, as I set out in relation to Rhoda Grant's amendment, namely that any provision has to have a clear legal effect. And this amendment does not. There is no duty that's placed on the Scottish ministers or relevant authorities. At stage two, I had responded to similar views expressed by stakeholders and the committee that the bill should include high-level objectives to reflect that broad vision and the ambitions for the Good Food Nation policy. And the approach taken in amendments lodged in my name were that rather than setting out a purpose provision as proposed by Rachel Hamilton, that a set of high-level principles were included in the bill in a format that would give them legal effect. The Scottish ministers and relevant authorities must have regard to the principles when developing the Good Food Nation plans, and the high level nature of the principles provides that clarity as to what's being asked of them. And it's for these reasons that I would urge members not to support amendments 15 and 16.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call Rhoda Grant to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 15. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm obviously very disappointed in the response from Government and indeed from the Greens. Their manifesto stated that this bill should include the right to food, and how quickly they have ditched their principles for a sniff of power. It is a disgrace. Stakeholders have called for this, and the Scottish Government are not listening. The right to food should be enshrined in this bill, but the Scottish Government have shown themselves absolutely disinterested in taking steps to deal with hunger and starvation that is happening here and now in Scotland. At stage two, the Cabinet Secretary stated clearly that having regard to did not bind them, and therefore the excuses she uses not to support this amendment are spurious at best. I would urge other members to look to their conscience and vote for this amendment.
Thank you, Ms Grant. The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a brief suspension to allow people to get online. Technical break, just to allow members to refresh their devices. Okay, so it'll be a short technical break. Thank you, colleagues. The question is that Amendment 15 be agreed. Members should cast their votes now. Point of order, Claire Adamson.
Thank you. Sorry, my app wouldn't work. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Adamson. We'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Ben McPherson. Can you wait for your microphone to come on, Mr McPherson? Point of order, Ben McPherson.
My apologies, Presiding Officer. I'd be grateful if you could check if my vote was recorded, and if not, I would have voted no.
It was recorded, Mr McPherson. Point of order, Shirley Ann Sunrival.
It doesn't appear that my app was working, and I
would have
voted no.
It was recorded, but your card wasn't in, so if you could do that, it would be fine. Anybody else? The result of the vote on Amendment number 15 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 18, no 64. There were 28 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I now call Amendment 16 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 15. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 16 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
No, there will be a 30-second vote on Amendment 16. Votes closed. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
My app did not connect and I was unable to vote. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. We'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, David Torrance. You need to have your microphone on, Mr Torrance.
My app didn't connect. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Torrance. We'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. My app didn't connect. I would have voted yes.
Thank you. We'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Claire Adamson.
Sorry, my app isn't connecting. I would have voted no.
Thank you. We'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Neil Gray, remotely.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Unfortunately, my app didn't connect. I would have voted no.
Thank you. We'll make sure that's recorded, Mr. Gray. Okay, the result of the vote on amendment number 16 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 44, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. We now move to Group 2, scrutiny of proposed plan, and call amendment 47 in the name of Colin Smith, group with amendments 49, 50 and 52. Colin Smith to move amendment 47 and speak to all amendments in the group. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendments 47, 49, 50 and 52 in my name seek to give Parliament a greater period of time than the 28 days currently proposed in the Bill to scrutinise the National Good Food Nation Plan. In the case of Amendment 49, it requires Scottish Ministers to lay the proposed plan before the Scottish Parliament for a period of 60 days, of which no fewer than 30 must be sitting days. During Stage 2, I brought forward a proposal for this period to be 120 days based on the Climate Change Act 2019. The Minister raised concerns over the possible impact on the timetable to produce a plan and agreed to work with me following Stage 2. As a result of this and following discussions, Amendment 49 is a compromise between the current requirement to lay the plan for a period of 28 days and my previous amendment for 120 days. Amendments 47, 50 and 52 are simply consequential to Amendment 59. Amendment 50, for example, makes changes to Section 1B1 to provide that Scottish Ministers must have regard to the things listed in Sections 1-1B during the consideration period rather than before the expiry of the consideration period. Amendment 52 amends Section 1B to remove subsections 4 and 5, which relate to the 28-day period. And Amendment 47 amends Section 1B2 of the Bill to specify the subsection of Section 1B, which contains the details of the length of the consideration period. Presiding Officer, concerns over the lack of opportunity for Parliament to scrutinise the plan was a recurring theme in both stakeholder responses and the committee's report. I therefore urge members to support the amendments to ensure Parliament is given a period beyond the current planned provision of 28 days to effectively hold the Scottish Government to account and how it delivers our collective ambitions to be a good food nation through any proposed national good food national plan. I therefore move Amendment 47 in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. Smith. I now call on the Cabinet Secretary to respond. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Colin Smith has just outlined, at Stage 2, we had both lodged amendments which would introduce a requirement to lay a draft version of the National Good Food Nation Plan before the Scottish Parliament for a period of consideration. And my amendment had set out a period of 28 days, which had been agreed by committee, and Colin Smith's amendment had set out a period of 120 days. And I'd agreed to work with Colin Smith to agree a compromise, and that's why I fully support the amendments that have been put forward today to require a consideration period of 60 days.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Colin Smith to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 47. Mr. Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy just to press the amendment.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. That is agreed. We turn now to Group 3, Content of Plans, and I call Amendment 17 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Rachel Hamilton to move Amendment 17 and speak to all amendments in the group. Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you. The Good Food Nation Bill represents an opportunity to tackle some of the most pressing issues that Scotland are facing, and I have no doubt that the Scottish Government will agree that tackling child poverty would be one of these issues. I know that Monica Lennon will also be pressing amendments to achieve similar aims, which my colleagues and I will support. This has taken on added importance given the global inflationary pressures families across the world are facing. And although the UK Government continue to implement measures to alleviate these pressures, this amendment would pull on a lever available to the Scottish Government to go even further. Amendment 17, which I move in my name, would include tackling child poverty as an issue that this bill must give regard to. As part of this, the delivery of free school breakfasts in Scottish schools should be included. I will shortly move a similar amendment which these aims on the provision of the free supply of milk to children in preschool, nurseries and primary school settings will benefit from, which Monica Lennon actually moved in stage two, but it fell. And I'd also like to make a comment on Ross Greer's, the Green Party's education spokesperson at this point. I just presume that he hadn't had his Weetabix when he made comment that morning with regards to providing initiatives to provide free school meals. That's regrettable that he had done that. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Brian Whittle to speak to Amendment 1 and all other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I move Amendments 1 and the other amendments in my name. My amendments are really there to ensure that the Scottish Government are declaring the outcomes of the Good Nation Bill and that they are fully understood and resourced to make it as simple as possible for food producers, local authorities, food procurement contracts and hospital contracts, and they are as connected as possible. I think legislation to connect up relevant parties to make the bills asks of our food producers and local authorities and hospitals as straightforward as we can. I can start with Amendment 3 that asks that the Good Food Nation Plan must set out how the relevant authority will ensure that at least 60% of the food it procures is sourced within the UK, except in exceptional circumstances, and also that free school meals will be locally sourced. For so many reasons, this has to be the direction of travel of this bill. For health reasons, given that Scotland has the unwanted tag of the unhealthiest nation in Europe, reducing life expectancy and already less than the rest of the United Kingdom. Regular, fresh, local produce food can be a huge step to addressing this health inequality. For the rural economy, we charge our farmers with producing some of the highest quality food in the world. We have the highest standards of animal welfare. We give them custodianship of the countryside and ask them to pay the living wage. Surely we must then reward them with purchasing that produce at a fair price. To help us with our climate change targets, farmers are given such an unfair, hard time on emissions and climate change. So why are we importing so much of our food for public procurement contracts with all the air miles, road miles associated with this ridiculous behaviour? We have hospitals who have food procured, prepared and pre-packaged in Wales and driven up the M6 to be reheated in the hospitals with over 50% of it wasted. Where is the common sense in that? I think recent events have highlighted all too starkly how we must protect and develop our own food security. If we don't support our own food producers right now, we risk losing them for good, necessitating further imports. And that brings me to Amendment 2. If we're going to require local councils and relevant authorities to develop plans to improve local procurement and good food standards, then we should be making it easier for them to attain those standards. The Central Excel contract is a Scottish Government contract that, when it first entered into Parliament, procured just 16% of its food from Scotland. It imported chicken from Thailand, it had root vegetables and fruit from Europe, potato powder from Ireland and many dairy produce from abroad. All foodstuffs that's produced here in Scotland with a capacity to increase if the demand dictates. That poor record has hardly improved in the intervening 6 years, to the shame of this Parliament. Making a bold statement, taking the lead and creating an Excel contract that procures at least 60% of its food from the UK, Scotland preferably, shows serious intent and allows local councils and authorities an easy route to hitting their targets. Finally, to Amendment 1, by agreeing to my Amendment 2 and 3, it makes the improving of fresh food standards for schools and hospitals well within reach. Surely that's the outcome that we all want. And part of the Good Food Nation Bill must contain an educational element, highlighting improving food literacy, where food comes from and how we process food. Too many today have no idea of how food is produced and processed. If we're going to get buy-in from the consumer, that, I think, needs to be dealt with. Reducing food waste, with a third of all food wasted, we have created a world where, if food waste were a country, it would be the third biggest emitter of greenhouse gases after China and the USA. It takes a landmass the size of China to produce the food that we throw away. But for me, the most critical is, if we could feed the world starving, if we wasted just a quarter less than we currently do. And that's what I'm asking for here, reducing food waste from over 30% to less than 20% by 2025. And it can be done. There's a school in East Ayrshire where they threw away 40% of their food. And what they did was, one of the teachers, after lunchtime, took that food put it, they've got to put it into meal-sized boxes, froze the food, took yesterday's food out, left it on a table, and children were allowed to just come and lift that as they will at 4 o'clock in the afternoon under the auspices of protecting the environment. There was no other criteria put in place, so they now have no food waste. Finally, Presiding Officer, we must process food closer to home. We cannot be sending food down south and further afield for processing and packaging. Again, this speaks to health. It speaks to the local economy and to our environment. We do not process much of our produce here in Scotland, so increasing that capacity by 50% by 2030 is actually not much of an ask, but it is a statement of intent that encourages the private sector to help grow that capacity. And remember, all of this is against a backdrop where East Ayrshire actually procures 75% of its food locally. So it can be done. These amendments are enablers. They put in place building blocks to help hit the targets we're looking for. They are eminently sensible and achievable. To not pass them would be to pass the buck to local authorities and abdicate responsibility. Let's actually make legislation and that enables change. I ask the Parliament to support my amendments. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. And I call the Cabinet Secretary to speak to Amendment 18 and other amendments in the group. Cabinet Secretary.
I just want to start by reiterating what I've said throughout this process, because this bill is a framework bill and it does exactly that. It sets out a framework for the Good Food Nation plans, and many of the amendments in this group would detail specific outcomes or other matters which plans must contain. So, for example, Amendment 64 in Monica Lennon's name on universal free school meals. And first of all, I just want to thank Monica Lennon for meeting with me to discuss her intention to bring forward amendments at stage three in relation to universal free school meals. I know that this is an issue that is of great importance to the member, as it is to me and other members across this chamber too. And our programme for government set out our ambitions to provide free school breakfasts and lunches to local authority primary school pupils in Scotland all year round and for all children in state-funded special schools in Scotland. And we have made significant progress against that commitment. Scotland already offers the most generous provision of free school lunches in the UK, and local authority pupils in primary 1 to 5 and in special schools already benefit from the offer of universal free school meals. Now, we are fully committed to the expansion of free school meals over the course of this parliamentary session, and we'll continue to work with local authorities to plan for this over the next academic year. But I will come back to the detail of Monica Lennon's amendment shortly, and now I'll move on to set out my view on the amendments in this group. In relation to putting outcomes, indicators or targets on the face of the bill, my view remains the same on that. It is really challenging to ensure that these are and that they remain up to date and meaningful if they're set out in primary legislation. And there is a risk that future food plans solely focus on those targets to neglect of other equally important considerations. And we want the plans to cover the whole of the wide-ranging nature of the Good Food Nation vision. So it's for that reason that I'm of the firm view that the place for this level of detail is in the plans themselves. And I know that that was also the considered view of the Rain Committee in their Stage 1 report, that the bill should contain high-level objectives, but not the detailed targets and outcomes. Amendment 18 in my name has been lodged in response to concerns raised by some stakeholders, as well as by members of the committee, that there was no clear recognition of the role that the private sector plays across the food supply chain. The Good Food Nation plans will contain policies and initiatives that will inevitably involve or affect the private sector in different ways. And this amendment would require the Scottish ministers to set out in the National Good Food Nation plan how they intend to ensure that the implementation of the policies in section 1.3c is informed by the views of the private sector. I do want to address concerns that I've heard voiced by some stakeholders in recent days about this amendment. And I want to be clear that the amendment isn't about giving food companies a hand in creating government policy, but it is instead about making sure that we properly take into account the views of those that grow, process, transport and sell food around how we implement policies decided by government. And given the significant role that businesses of all sizes play in the food supply chain, no government policy would succeed without at least understanding the views of business on how such policy would work in practice. And this is a duty to essentially garner those views, not necessarily to act on them. I would also draw members' attention to the definition of the food business sector in section 14.1. because it includes everyone involved in the food industry, regardless of their size or role. And the aim of that is to recognise the role that the private sector plays across the supply chain and provide a mechanism by which the views of the food business sector will inform the implementation of the policies in the plan. And Amendment 20 in my name would amend Section 1.5 of the Bill to clarify that the requirement to have regard to the list of high-level outcomes in that subsection applies when determining the content of the National Good Food Nation Plan, so far as that's required by Section 1.3 of the Bill. In relation to Brian Whittle's Amendments 2 and 3, they would place targets in relation to procurement on the face of the Bill. So, for example, Amendment 2 would require the Scottish Government Central Excel contract to procure at least 60% of food from within the UK by 2025. And I know that these were similar to amendments lodged at Stage 2, which weren't agreed to at that time. As I'd set out at Stage 2, there are strict rules around procurement, and this may mean that the intended aim can't be achieved. The Trade and Cooperation Agreement with the EU contains a duty of non-discrimination in procurement, so these amendments aren't compatible with our international obligations, and that's why I'm unable to support them today. However, the Scottish Government does support the use of procurement to improve the social, economic and environmental well-being of our areas, and we do promote and facilitate procurement of healthy, fresh and seasonal produce in contracts for food and catering too. Amendment 1 in Brian Whittle's name would set out a series of outcomes that the National Good Food Nation Plan must include, including targets around food waste and food processing capacity. And Rachel Hamilton's Amendments 48 and 65 make reference to the Food for Life accreditation, setting out that this should be one of the indicators used to assess progress in achieving the outcomes of the Good Food Nation Plans. Amendment 66 would require local authorities to set out in their Good Food Nation plans their plans to achieve accreditation under the Food for Life scheme. Now, I absolutely support the aims and objectives of the Food for Life programme and acknowledge just the great work that has been done through that, meaning that we now have 18 local authorities with Food for Life accreditation. However, it isn't appropriate to set out that level of detail on the face of the bill. The process of obtaining Food for Life accreditation is a policy initiative that is best dealt with at local authority level, and they will set out the indicators that will measure progress against the outcomes set out in their plans. Setting out an indicator in legislation when the Good Food Nation plans are yet to be drafted is problematic, particularly when consultation on those local plans hasn't yet taken place. I would also bring to members' attention that the reference in Amendment 65 in Rachel Hamilton's name, I think it should be to subsection 4B of Section 7 rather than subsection 3B as it's currently stated. And my view on Amendments 1, 48, 65 and 66 is, as I've set out throughout the bill process, that this is a framework bill and the appropriate place for this level of detail is within the plans themselves. And I would therefore ask that members don't support those amendments. Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 63 would require relevant authorities to set out how they intend to work with other relevant authorities in their area to share good practice and to secure the achievement of the outcomes for individuals in receipt of social care. However, it's not clear how that amendment would work in practice. So, for example, the wording in its area is difficult to interpret because it doesn't mean working with relevant authorities within the exact same area, with those that overlap boundaries or with those that are adjacent to the local authority. The amendment also includes wording that's specific to social care, and it's not clear whether the sharing of good practice is a general requirement or it is one that is specific to social care. And it's for those reasons that I would ask members not to support that amendment. There are several amendments in relation to the provision of food in schools. Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 17 would add to Section 1 of the Bill a requirement for the Scottish Ministers to set out the policies that they intend to pursue to reduce child poverty, including the delivery of free school breakfast in all Scottish schools. And Section 1.5 of the Bill, as amended at Stage 2, already requires that Scottish Ministers, when determining the content of the National Good Food Nation Plan, to have regard to the scope of food-related issues to affect outcomes in relation to child poverty. The policies to reduce child poverty will be set out in the plan itself, which, as I've previously set out, is the appropriate place for the detail of those policies to be set out. The wording of this amendment would also require Scottish Ministers to set out how they would ensure the provision of free breakfast to all schools in Scotland, including those that wouldn't be under the control of local authorities. And I would query how that would target those children who are in most need of that support. Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 19 would require the National Good Food Nation Plan to set out how the Scottish Ministers will ensure the free supply of milk to children in preschool, nurseries and primary schools. The Scottish Government has committed to delivering a universal Scottish free school milk scheme to local authority primary and special schools and to develop a pilot in local authority secondary schools. And the wording of this amendment would also require Scottish ministers to set out how they would ensure free milk to primary schools not under the control of local authorities, which is out with the scope of the current commitment that we have. And as I've set out previously, again, this is a framework bill and it wouldn't be appropriate to be prescriptive on the face of the bill about which specific policies should be contained within the plans. And similar amendments in relation to free school milk were lodged at stage two by Monica Lennon, but these weren't agreed to for the same reasons that I've just outlined. Beatrice Wishart's Amendment 29 would require local authorities, when formulating their Good Food Nation plans, to ensure that there is flexibility in meal provision, and in particular, not to restrict the ability of residents in any school hostels operated by the local authority to make choices in relation to their meals. Evening meals provided in hostels that are run by local authorities must comply with the nutrient standards that are set out in the Nutritional Requirements for Food and Drink in Schools Scotland Regulations 2020, which help ensure that young people are provided with an appropriate amount of energy and key nutrients to support their healthy growth and development. And the food and drink standards set out in the regulations also apply at mealtimes and are designed to limit the amount of fat, saturated fat, salt and sugar provided as part of a balanced diet. The regulations are already flexible enough to allow school hostel caterers to design menus that meet the needs and preferences of hostel residents. In relation to Brian Whittle's Amendment 3 that would require free school meals provided by the local authority to be locally sourced, I would just refer to my earlier comments about the strict rules around procurement, but also to the good work that's already been carried out under the Food for Life accreditation scheme that promotes the use of local food. This work is already underway and there are also plans to run a pilot programme looking at expanding Food for Life into the wider public sector. Turning now to Monica Lennon's Amendment 64, this would require a relevant authority's Good Food Nation plan to set out how the relevant authority intends to ensure that universal free school meals for all children and young people, high uptake, free of stigma of universal free school meals and the provision of high quality nutritious food during school holidays. However, careful consideration is required so that a requirement such as this isn't added to legislation in a way which it may not achieve the desired aim. And this, as I've noted throughout the bill process, again, is a framework bill and the place for the detail is in the Good Food Nation plans themselves. And I also don't believe that the wording of the amendments put forward by Monica Lennon achieves the intended aim. The proposed amendment applies to all relevant authorities, and this would include local authorities, health boards and all bodies specified in regulations made under Section 7.2, who would have to include in their plans how they intend to ensure the provision of universal free school meals. However, health boards have no role in the provision of school meals to pupils, and as such, that would require them to explain how they would do something which they ultimately have no responsibility to do. And in relation to local authorities, it isn't just restricted to pupils at schools under the authority's control, and so would require the aspect of the plan to extend to independent schools and grant-aided schools. Monica Lennon's amendment wouldn't impose a direct duty on a relevant authority to provide universal free school meals, but it does require a relevant authority to include in their plan how they intend to ensure the provision of universal free school meals and the other matters that are set out in paragraphs B and C of Amendment 64. Now, where legislation seeks to impose a legal duty on a person or body, the duty should be express, clear and unambiguous, both in the fact that a duty is being imposed, but also the terms of the duty. So a duty could not be created by adding an amendment in this way. This would require relevant authorities to explain in their plan how they would ensure something that they currently have no duty to do. And in relation to paragraph C, the provision of meals during school holidays to ensure something that isn't yet a right in Scots law. The requirement in paragraph B to set out how the authority would ensure the high uptake of free school meals and how that would be done free of stigma duplicates insofar as it relates to the existing legal duty to provide free school meals, the duties on education authorities under Section 53A, promotion of school lunches, and Section 53B, protection of identity of pupils receiving free school meals of the Education Scotland Act 1980. And in contrast with the 1980 Act, there is no definition of school meal and no reference to free school meals being provided to pupils in attendance at schools, and it instead refers to children and young people. So it is really unclear what is intended. So, for example, should it extend to independent schools and home education of children and young people, and how that relates to the 1980 Act duties? I hope that the reasons I've set out do explain the significant issues concerning these amendments, and that's why I would strongly urge members not to accept them for the reasons that I've set out.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call Beatrice Wishart to speak to Amendment 29 and other amendments in the group. Ms Wishart.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Amendment 29 in my name requires local authorities to ensure that their Good Food Nation plans allow for flexibility in meal provision, and in particular don't restrict the ability of residents in any school hostels operated by a local authority to make choice in relation to their meals. This amendment has been created to avoid situations that have been brought to my attention in which school hostel pupils felt restricted by the prescriptive nature of their meal provision. In school hostels, which are a pupil's home from home for many, all meals of the day are provided and follow school meal regulations, which can lead to pupils feeling that their meals are too prescriptive and do not allow any flexibility for their own choices and independence. Being overly prescriptive with meal provision in school hostels can remove the enjoyment and social elements from meals and can result in pupils rejecting hostel meals to buy unhealthier alternatives elsewhere. As we're aware, habits created in life early in life are hard to break, and it's an irony that guidance to ensure healthy food provision is driving learners to unhealthy options. Providing food has to be about ensuring not only nutrition, but also the social and cultural aspects of food, as well as individual preferences. So this amendment would ensure that this issue is taken into account in settings where all meals are provided by the relevant authority, particularly in school hostels. I move Amendment 29.
Thank you, Ms Wishart. I now call Monica Lennon to speak to Amendment 64 and other amendments in the group. Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just start by saying I'm sorry that the Cabinet Secretary is unwell today and unable to join us in the chamber. I hope she's feeling better soon. I will keep my remarks limited to Amendment 64. On these benches, we are supporting all amendments in the group, but I know we're pushed for time today. The inspiration behind Amendment 64 is, it's no secret, it's the STUC's trailblazing campaign, Food for Thought, making real the rights of all young people to food, education and fun. This campaign is widely supported by MSPs and political parties, all trade unions, anti-poverty charities and children and young people's organisations. So what will the amendment do? Well, Amendment 64 would require the Good Food Nation plan of a relevant authority set out how it will intend to ensure A, the provision of universal free school meals for all children and young people, B, high uptake of those meals in ways that are inclusive and free of stigma, and C, the fulfilment of children and young people's right to high quality nutritious food during the holiday period. And building upon my child poverty amendment that was approved at stage two, this amendment seeks to strengthen Section 7 of the Bill. And Section 7, as we've heard, places requirements on public bodies, and that's important, public bodies, to produce Good Food Nation plans. And Section 7 of the Bill, as amended at Stage 2, makes clear that that talks about areas that they have responsibility for. So we're not trying to throw in things that public bodies have no responsibility for. And when you read the bill, it's quite clear that there wouldn't be duplication of efforts. I think we should all agree that building a Good Food Nation must start with getting it right for all children and young people. Universal free school meal provision is a critical policy mechanism to help alleviate poverty, mitigate food insecurity, and support efforts to tackle the poverty-related attainment gap. It is also critically important in embedding whole-scale community approaches to nutrition, including the universal approach, including the approach to universal free school provision in the Good Food Nation Plan, will build upon the Scottish Government's very welcome commitment to incorporating the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. And expanding universal school meal provision will also help deliver on the Scottish Government's aspiration to significantly reduce child poverty and close the attainment gap, in addition to becoming a Good Food Nation by 2025. I think it's strange that the bill is silent on universal free school meals and the rights of children and young people. And just to remind the Chamber, I know everyone's had a letter in advance of today from Rose Foyer, who is the General Secretary of the STUC. The STUC represents over 500,000 workers in Scotland, including teachers who are having to feed children today out of their own pockets, and the workers who staff our school canteens. It's really important that we remember that. I'm grateful to Mary Gujon, the Cabinet Secretary, for her time, and I think her willingness to engage in the issues. But I do really feel, by not supporting the amendment today, that the government is missing a trick, because we can have all the good intentions and all the good policies, but if we're not putting it into action, we're not helping people who need the help. Just last week in this chamber at First Minister's Questions, we were reminded of the rise in hidden hunger that is happening in our schools right now. Young people have told Aberlour that their friends who are not eligible for free school meals are going hungry at lunchtime. That is happening in Scottish schools today, while others are deliberately saving up their lunch money to give it back to their parents. That is just shameful. I think it is positive that the Scottish Conservatives are backing this amendment. I think it's positive that the Scottish Liberal Democrats are backing the amendment. And when I listen to Scotland's children and young people, they say that they want all MSPs to work together to make their rights real. I know that Ross Greer's not in the chamber at the moment, and he might think it's somehow a disgrace that parties would work together. I think it's actually really positive that we now, I know the vote might not reflect on it today, but I think we now have a position where everybody in this Parliament wants to expand universal free school meals beyond nursery and primary school into our secondary schools, because the issues and challenges don't end at the gates of our primary schools. But it is regrettable that the government and our coalition partners didn't have the foresight to bring these issues into the bill. It's always more challenging for backbenchers and opposition members to try and do that. But I do take at face value the good will from the Cabinet Secretary. My plea, if members are not going to support this today, is that we recognise the cross-cutting issues around food, around education and children and young people's rights, and that every minister in government redoubles efforts to make sure that children are not going without food. We have to question whether we are doing all that we can. And if we vote against this amendment tonight, then we're not doing all that we can, but we'll have to come back again tomorrow and the next day and try and do better. That is what the children and young people are demanding from each and every one of us. That's what the STUC are saying with one clear voice, that no longer will the workers who staff our schools and who look after children across Scotland accept crumbs from the government table. We have to do more. We have to start focusing on what we can do instead of what we can't do. And I think, just to conclude, Presiding Officer, I welcome the feedback from the Cabinet Secretary, and I fully understand the need for legislation to be well drafted and not to have unintended consequences. When I was meeting the Cabinet Secretary yesterday, I said some of the objections I was hearing had parallels with the period poverty legislation when the political will wasn't there. So I would ask perhaps the Green members to reflect on that. This shouldn't be about party politics and who's bringing forward the amendment. We have time to get this right. People should look to their own conscience. And I know there's people on the back benches today who really want to back this amendment. It will be a real shame if there's pressure from their party whips to do otherwise. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you, Ms. Lennon. I now call Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. In the absence of the opportunity to intervene in the Cabinet Secretary's lengthy response, I'd be grateful for the opportunity to ask the Cabinet Secretary some questions on her response. Amendment 18 in the Cabinet Secretary's name makes provision for the implementation of policies relating to the National Good Food Nations Plan to be informed by the private food business sector, which I don't have an issue with, but maybe the Cabinet Secretary could explain why that many other sectors with an interest in those policies have been excluded from this particular statutory foot in sectors such as those concerned with social wellbeing, climate change, wildlife, the natural environment, animal welfare and workers' rights. Should they not have the same statutory rights as the private food sector? Turning to the other amendments, it was deeply disappointing that the Cabinet Secretary continues to oppose the bill having a small number of high-level objectives and measurable indicators linked to outcomes which would better enable the monitoring and scrutiny of progress. The Scottish Government has passed a number of bills in the last few years which include targets and outcomes on the face of the bill, the Climate Change Emissions Reduction Target Bill, the Child Poverty Scotland Act and, just recently, the Draft Circular Economy Bill published would enable secondary legislation to set targets. So can the Cabinet Secretary explain why food legislation does not require statutory targets to ensure the Scottish Government's objectives are reached and that food security is delivered across Scotland, but other legislation does require targets on the face of the bill?
Thank you, Mr Smith. I can confirm I will go back to the Cabinet Secretary before asking Rachel Hamilton to wind up, but first I'm calling Ariane Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm sympathetic with the aims of the amendments in this group to expand the provision of free food to school-aged children. It's an important step towards closing the attainment gap. However, we have a responsibility to ensure that amendments passed in this chamber can be put into effect. I will start by addressing Amendment 64 from Monica Lennon, which would introduce a blanket approach to school meal provision, including providing food to those who attend fee-paying schools where arguably there's not a need. The amendment text, as drafted, would also apply to all relevant authorities under the bill, even those with no role in the provision of school meals. It is unclear who the duties are to apply to, and as this issue was also not raised with the committee during our evidence gathering at stage one, we have not collectively agreed recommendations on this issue. I'm disappointed that instead Labour is raising this issue at the 11th hour when time to agree a constructive way forward has run out.
Are you taking intervention?
Yes, I'm taking intervention.
Monica Lennon.
I'm grateful to the member for taking the intervention. It was disappointing that the member voted against the earlier iteration of the amendment at stage two without any question, following the instructions from the SNP Cabinet Secretary. But this is not the 11th hour. This is a campaign by the STUC that the Scottish Greens signed up to prior to the election last year, made a flagship commitment in your manifesto, which I absolutely welcome. It's a shame that your party has forgotten all about that.
Through the chair, Ms Lennon, please.
Sorry. And it's a shame that the Green Party has forgotten that, Presiding Officer. But can I ask, is the member now saying that the Scottish Green position has changed? Are you now, as a party, in favour of means testing? And where in the amendment or the bill does it relate to independent schools? Which public body has responsibility for independent schools?
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the member for that intervention, and I just want to say that I am proud that the Scottish Greens have already taken steps to widen free school meal entitlement, as we have committed to. This includes using budget negotiations to expand free school meal provision to all pupils in P1 to P3 and P1 to P5, covering more than 120,000 children. We've also provided councils with more than £30 million this year to upgrade school catering facilities ahead of further expansion. And we will continue to work constructively with the government to secure further progress. I'll turn briefly to the other amendments in this group. As this is a framework bill, Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 17 and 19 on school breakfast and milk provision are at a level of detail that would be best placed in the Good Food Nation plans rather than on the face of the bill. I also note that the Scottish Government has already committed to delivering a universal free school milk scheme to local authorities and special schools and will pilot a rollout in secondary schools. Amendment 48, 65 and 68 also include detail on accreditation schemes that would be better placed in plans than in legislation. And Brian Whittle's amendment in this group would insert a number of targets into the bill, and as discussed at stage two, these are problematic in framework legislation of this kind. Additionally, as they touch on issues of trade, we must be careful in how provisions in the bill would interact with the WTO rules and the UK's trade agreements with the EU. We will support amendments 18 and 20 from the Cabinet Secretary, which ensure that the Good Food Nation plans are realistic and informed by those who work in the sector, from farmers and crofters through jobs in the supply chain to hospitality and retail. Since the private sector accounts for the vast majority of food supply and will be impacted by the plans, it is crucial to involve them from the start of the journey to a Good Food Nation plan. No, I won't take an adventure. I'm just winding up. Finally, Amendment 26 from Beatrice Wishart seeks to ensure flexibility in meal provision in local authority-run hostels. This is already provided for in the Nutritional Requirements for Food and Drink in Schools, Scotland Regulations 2020, and so we will not be supporting this amendment today. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. As we are nearing the agreed time limit, I am prepared to exercise my power under Rule 9.8.4A to allow the debate on this group to continue beyond the limit in order to avoid the debate being unreasonably curtailed. And with that, I call Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think the Good Food Nation Bill was such an opportunity to tackle health issues and education issues that have plagued this government, to support the rural economy and to commit to climate change. What the Scottish Government are doing is actually asking local authorities to come up with plans. But in the Cabinet Secretary's response, she's indicated that the Scottish Government are unwilling to make uncontentious amendments to the bill. Amendments that are supported by the NFU. And I do understand procurement law quite well, and there's nothing in these amendments that contravene that law. And the fact of the matter is, East Ayrshire have been doing exactly what my amendments asked for years. So that argument does not hold water at all. The reality is we could put these onto the face of the bill and we could use secondary legislation to change anything we need to do in the future. The reality is Scottish Government are risk-averse, and without tangible outcomes means that there is no way of us measuring success or otherwise. They are abdicating their responsibility. And as for the Greens, they have just abdicated all their responsibilities and all their principles. The Scottish Government have missed a huge opportunity here, and it will leave the Good Food Nation Bill a shell of what it should have been, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to respond before I invite Rachel Hamilton to wind up. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'll try and cover most of the points that have been raised there. I think reflecting on Colin Smith's issues and the points that he'd raised, I mean, this certainly isn't about excluding others in relation to the amendments that I've brought forward. But I think it recognises that all the initiatives that we're going to take forward will involve the private sector in practice. And I do think it is really important to remember that everyone is going to have an opportunity to input into the development of the food plans. And we've said already that we want our consultation to be as broad and inclusive as possible. So, of course, there will be that opportunity there for people to feed into it. And it's also important to remember that, you know, we brought this amendment forward because we listened to the evidence that the committee had heard when it was taking evidence throughout the passing of the bill. And it takes into account that evidence that was taken by the committee, which is why we've brought this forward too. And also in relation to the outcomes and indicators, you know, as stated at committee and agreed to by them too, the face of the bill isn't the place for the targets and the outcomes that we want to see. That some of those that had been proposed at stage two would have become out of date very quickly. And we are not averse to looking at outcomes and indicators and how we monitor our progress, but just that the detail of that should be within the Good Food Nation plans themselves. And also, just coming back to Monica Lennon's points as well, and I would really welcome the discussions that I've had with the member in relation to the amendments that she's brought forward. And we did have some really constructive discussions, I felt, and with the trade union representatives as well, because absolutely, and I don't think we're far apart in what we're trying to achieve here. But again, I think there are specific issues that we have with the particular amendments that have been brought forward, which I've outlined today. But I do also hope that I've been really clear in terms of the commitment that we've made to the expansion of free school meals. You know, it's this government that has enacted that and really taken that and driven it forward. And we're committed to working with our local authority partners to take that further forward as well. So I do hope that the members across the chamber can take some assurance from that today. But again, there are particular issues with those amendments as they've been brought forward, as there are in relation to the amendments that have been brought forward by both Brian Whittle and two. So again, it's for those reasons that I would urge members not to support those amendments.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to take a brief intervention from Finlay Carson, and we come back to you again, Cabinet Secretary. Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just unclear what the protocol was with the Minister attending remotely. It was back in 2016 that the SNP first put the commitment to the Good Food Nation in its manifesto, but failed to deliver. And in 2021, the regurgitated Good Food Nation suggested that we're going to create a single market brand for Scotland called Sustainability Scotland. They were also going to create a single independent Scottish food agency, but yet we hear today over and over and over this is a framework bill. So why has the Cabinet Secretary failed to deliver on the aspirations of the stakeholders that have engaged in the belief that this bill was going to be transformational, and we've got the bill in front of us which is not fit for purpose?
I'm going to call Monica Lennon.
Oh, thank you, Presiding Officer. Yeah, my question to the Cabinet Secretary, and I welcome what she's saying in the tone of it, but again, it's about action. I know she's raised a concern about children who are homeschooled, and if this was in the Good Food plan, how would that work? Is it the government's view that children who are homeschooled should be excluded from accessing universal free school meals? We know from our constituency mailbags that there are many children who are homeschooled, sometimes because they have additional support needs and the school has not been properly resourced to meet their needs. What will the government do in the meantime to support those children if they are experiencing hunger?
Thank you. And I'm going to call the Cabinet Secretary again before calling Rachel Hamilton. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Touching on that last point first, I mean, obviously we don't want to see any child or any young person going hungry, which is why we've taken a number of pieces of action to try and combat the poverty and the extreme poverty that we know people are facing at the moment. But again, I think that the amendments as have been brought forward to today, there are particular issues with that, which is why we're in a position that we're unable to support them. But the commitment in relation to the provision of free school meals is still there. And coming back to the points that Finlay Carson had raised as well. I mean, he raised some of the other manifesto commitments that the government is still committed to taking forward. And I suppose I would just completely disagree with his comment that the bill isn't fit for purpose. You know, we've listened to the evidence that the committee's taken. We brought forward a number of amendments taking into account the evidence that they've heard and their own recommendations within the report as well. So I would just disagree with that statement.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Rachel Hamilton to wind up, to press or withdraw Amendment 17. Ms Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I will press Amendment 17. And if it's OK, I would like to respond to the Cabinet Secretary's comments on particularly Amendment 48, 65 and 66 and 63, which I didn't originally move. So apologies for that, Presiding Officer. But Amendment 48, which I want to speak to with regard to the Food for Life scheme, which I can't understand why the SNP government will not support children within school settings to eat their five a day by encouraging all schools and all local authorities to adopt that whole school approach and embed that in the bill. Because we know that independent evaluation has shown that that pupils in Food for Life engaged schools are twice as likely to eat their five a day compared to children in matched comparison schools. So it would be good to hear really why, because I don't believe for the reasons that she's given, that it's problematic. With regards to Amendment 17 and 19, I believe that those amendments, I just want to reiterate, they actually strengthen the outcomes to tackle child poverty alongside the pilot that the government is putting forward for developing free school meals. And with regards to Ariane Burgess's comments, I mean, there was plenty of time within the committee process to actually have addressed some of the issues that if the Greens are so passionate about ensuring that children don't go hungry. And just on Amendment 63, I want to be clear that I don't see the problems with overlapping on boundaries of local authorities, Cabinet Secretary, because those could be overcome. And these amendments were brought forward at stage two with regards to the importance of the outcomes for individuals in receipt of social care. We know that we've got a national care strategy coming along. So why doesn't the Cabinet Secretary believe that the provision of food is integral to social care? You know, whether it's early years provision at home care, crisis care or residential care. I just think it's important that she recognises that this bill should have teeth, this bill should have ambition, and unfortunately it hasn't been delivered by this government.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. I do wonder whether you were expecting the Cabinet Secretary to come. I'll invite the Cabinet Secretary to make any response to any of the comments that Rachel Hamilton's made, and then I'll have to come back to you, Ms Hamilton, to formally move the amendment before we can proceed to a vote. Cabinet Secretary.
I would just reiterate the points that I made earlier in response to the points that have been raised by Rachel Hamilton, because it isn't clear from the amendments what they would be looking to achieve, and it's that lack of clarity in the language that's been used in the drafting of the amendments as to why we're in a position that we're not able to support them.
Thank you. And Rachel Hamilton, to move. The question is that Amendment 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a 1 minute division. Members should cast their votes now. Votes closed. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
My internet connection did not connect. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. That will be recorded. Point of order, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. Sorry, I would also have voted no. My vote wasn't recorded either, I don't think.
And you would have voted?
I would have voted no.
Thank you. I'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Kenneth Gibson.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I also would have voted no. No connection, I'm afraid.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Angus Robertson.
I would have voted no as well.
I'll make sure that's recorded. Thank you. And the result of the vote on amendment number 17 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 46, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. Can I call amendment number 1 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with amendment 17. Brian Whittle, to move or not move?
Move, Presiding Officer.
That amendment is moved. The question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? That's not agreed. There will be a 30-second division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote closed. Point of order from Claire Baker, who joins us remotely. Do you have Claire Baker's audio? Order, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you. My app said I have not voted. I believe I did vote, and I did vote yes.
Thank you, Ms. Duncan-Glancy. We'll make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Claire Baker, again. I'm afraid we've got connection issues there, so we'll just have to proceed, I'm afraid. And the result on amendment number 1 in the name of Brian Whittle is yes 42, no 66. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 2 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with amendment 17. Brian Whittle to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding Officer.
That is moved. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No, we are not agreed. There shall be a vote, and therefore members should cast their votes now. Vote's closed. Point of order, Neil Bibby.
My app didn't work, I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. Make sure that's recorded. And point of order, Shona Robinson online.
Yep, thanks. My app didn't connect, so I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms. Robinson. I'll make sure that is recorded. Point of order, Craig Hoy online.
Apologies, Deputy Presiding Officer. My app didn't work, but I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. We'll make sure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 2 in the name of Brian Whittle is yes 40, no 67. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 18 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with amendment 17. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 18 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. Call amendment 19 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 17. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. That is moved. The question is that amendment 19 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
That is not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. This will be a 30-second division. And the vote's closed.
Point of order.
Point of order, Neil Bibby.
Matt, I wouldn't connect again. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. Make sure that's recorded. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
Connection failed again. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. Make sure that's recorded. And the result of the vote on amendment 19 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 46, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 48 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 17. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Move.
That is moved. The question is that amendment 48 be agreed. Are we all agreed? That is not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast the votes now. Again, a 30-second division. And the vote is now closed. And the result of the vote on amendment number 48 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 46, no 64. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 20 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, already debated with amendment 17. Cabinet Secretary, to move formally.
Formally moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. We now move to group 4, matters to be taken into account in preparing plans. I call amendment 4 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, grouped with amendments 5, 8, 9, 10 and 14. Rachel Hamilton, to move amendment 4 and speak to all amendments in the group. Ms. Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My amendments on matters to be taken into account when the government or relevant authorities are preparing Good Food Nation plans seek to allow the bill to be updated when required. This will ensure the bill can be expanded to adapt developments. The last 2 years have seen a lesson in how rapidly the world can change, and it's vital that the bills we pass in this Parliament are suitably adaptable in certain areas to keep up with this. Important legislation should not be allowed to stagnate, and my amendments will provide the necessary flexibility to prevent this from happening. Amendment 14 would ensure that any updates to matters to be taken into account when preparing plans are subject to the affirmative procedure, and I move the amendments in this group. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Hamilton. As nobody else is requested to speak, I call the Cabinet Secretary.
Stage 2, Rachel Hamilton lodged similar amendments, and I set out my concerns at that time regarding the particular wording of those and had asked the member to work with me to identify alternate wording, and I want to thank her for doing that ahead of Stage 3. These amendments would adjust the text in Section 1.5 and Section 7.6 to add further clarity on the need to have regard to, among other things, as well as the specific matters that are listed. And Amendment 10 would amend Section 7.6 to add any other matters specified by the Scottish Ministers to the list of high-level outcomes, which allows for flexibility to add other matters to that list in the future. I support these amendments and would encourage members to support them too.
Thank you. And I call Rachel Hamilton to write up, press or withdraw the amendments. Ms Hamilton.
I'd just like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for working with me in this group of these amendments, and I press the amendments. Thank you.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 4 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
That is agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of Rachel Hamilton. Already debated with Amendment 4. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is Amendment 5 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. That is agreed. Group 5 on the principles, and I call Amendment 21 in the name of Rhoda Grant, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. Rhoda Grant to move Amendment 21 and speak to all other amendments in the group. Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish to move Amendment 21 and speak to Amendments 22, 27, 30, 31 and 34. Amendments 21 and 30 ensure that regard must be had to the principles outlined not only when preparing plans but also when implementing them. Amendment 21 refers to Section 1A, placing duties on Scottish ministers, and Amendment 30 refers to Section 7A, referring to health boards, local authorities and other specified public authorities. Included in these principles is the fact that adequate food is a human right. As part of the right to an adequate standard of living set out in Article 11 of the International Covenant on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights, and is essential to the realisation of other human rights. Amendment 27 and 34 strengthen this principle in Section 1A and 7A, respectively, by adding how the plans can be used to ensure that this right is implemented. That is added to the end of the clause to ensure that the plans are used to ensure that the right is implemented in Scotland. As I said before, the government have acknowledged that this bill is a vehicle for ensuring access, people access to their human rights, and therefore it should ensure implementation. These amendments do just that. Amendment 22 and 31 place a duty on Scottish ministers to have due regard to Good Food Nation plans, which again strengthens this part of the bill. We are supportive of the other amendments in the group. I would like, however, to ask Rachel Hamilton for some clarity on her amendments 24, 25 and 26. It's well understood that processed food can be cheap but laden with fat, salt and sugar, and therefore is detrimental to health. However, some foods, especially plant-based food, can be highly processed when used as a meat substitute, and it could be argued that these foods are still nutritious and essential to a vegetarian or vegan diet. We would like to support these amendments because I believe the sentiments are right, but need reassurance from Rachel Hamilton that they will not have these unintended consequences.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I now call Ian Burgess to speak to Amendment 23 and other amendments in the group. Ms Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My amendments 23 and 33 make a small change to one of the principles,
that was added at stage two by the Cabinet Secretary. The bill states that Scottish ministers and relevant authorities must have regard to these principles in preparing their Good Food Nation plans. Principle B, as drafted, is the role of sustainable food production is contributing to mitigation of climate change, halting and reversing of loss of biodiversity and improvement in animal welfare. My amendments change the phrase sustainable food production to sustainable food systems and supply chain. This small change in wording carries significant meaning. First, it expands the sphere of consideration to include what happens to food after it's produced. This includes food consumption and food waste or reuse. The choices we all make about the food we eat, the choices public bodies make about the food they procure and serve, and how much of it goes to waste are crucial factors when it comes to sustainability of the food system. So I believe that should all be kept under consideration and included in this principle. Second, by explicitly including the supply chain within this principle on sustainability, it recognises the environmental improvements that can be made by, for example, using less packaging and shortening supply chains to reduce emissions from travel and refrigeration, while allowing for flexibility to fit the approach to particular circumstances. This complements the consideration of resilient supply chains in Principle E. My Amendment 23 makes this change in relation to the National Plan, and Amendment 33 makes this change in relation to relevant authorities' plans. I do not support the other amendments within this group, as I believe they are unnecessary and do not add significant meaning beyond which is already in the bill. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 24 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is a clear and undeniable link between ultra-processed food and poor health outcomes. Amendments 24, 25 and 26, which I move in my name, acknowledge this link and provide an impetus for the Good Food Nation plans to include provisions to reduce consumption of these foods in settings where it is possible through this bill. I understand the concern that has been raised by Rhoda Grant, and she will allow me, I will explain what an ultra-processed food is defined as. I do think that the concerns are perhaps unfounded when I looked at the concrete definitions of the term from the BMJ, the British Heart Foundation, the Soil Association, and even the BBC, all of which came to the same conclusions of how the term should be defined. And the Soil Association define it as foods which typically contain little or no whole foods, are ready to consume or heat, and are made using industrial additives and processes. They often bear little resemblance to the real foods found in nature. They are often high in fat, salt, and added sugar, and depleted in dietary fibre. And if that does, that description does satisfy Rhoda Grant's concerns, I would appreciate her support on these amendments, because they provide a fantastic opportunity to encourage the consumption of more whole foods whilst reducing the consumption of less healthy foods. On Amendment 32, my amendment on the importance of supply chain transparency, sustainability and traceability relates to the need for an enhanced approach to public sector procurement that this bill has the capacity to achieve. Understanding where our food comes from, how it is procured, and the impact of the food we consume on the environment are key considerations that must be made when these plans are being drawn up, and we heard evidence to that effect. These considerations should influence how relevant authorities and the Scottish Government conduct future food procurement. In turn, this amendment would help foster more sustainable supply chains for public sector bodies and help improve the overall quality of the food it procures. On Ariane Burgess's amendment, we will be supporting her amendment. However, I am disappointed that we went through all these stages without any discussion from the Greens regarding some of these amendments that have been brought forward at this stage. So that is disappointing, but we will be supporting that amendment. Thank you. I move the amendments in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Monica Lennon to speak to Amendment 67 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Bear with me here as I'm drowning in too much paper. apologies. Sorry.
Sorry, I'm afraid I've managed to lose my piece of paper on that, presiding officer. I know that this amendment isn't going to be supported by SNP and Green members. It does fit with the amendment that was discussed in the earlier grouping, and again, it is about trying to embed the rights of children and young people into the bill. I have reached out to colleagues as recently as last night, so it's disappointing that it's not going to get support. But again, hopefully what the Cabinet Secretary said earlier on about the willingness to work beyond this bill today is something that we can take at face value. And I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I call on the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And just to deal with Rhoda Grant's amendments first, Amendments 21 and 30 would require the Scottish Ministers and relevant authorities, respectively, to have regard to the principles set out in Sections 1A and 7A when implementing the Good Food Nation plans, in addition to the current requirement to have regard to the principles when preparing the plans. The existing duty to have regard to the principles when preparing the Good Food Nation plans will ensure that consideration will be given to the principles when implementing the plans, since the policies included in the plans will have been prepared after having had regard to the principles. And Amendments 22 and 31 propose changing the duty in Sections 1A and 7A from have regard to have due regard. I set out the Scottish Government's position clearly at Stage 2 that the appropriate legal duty is to have regard to, because that's a meaningful legal requirement, and it's an obligation to consider that matter when we're making a decision. Amendments 27 and 34 propose amending Sections 1A and 7A to add wording about ensuring the right to adequate food is implemented. And Sections 1A and 7A start with the duty for Scottish Ministers to have regard to the principles when preparing their plans, so there is already that need to have regard to this right when formulating the plans. And it's for these reasons that I would ask members not to support these amendments. Turning now to Rachel Hamilton's amendments 24, 25 and 26, these all propose the addition of wording to Section 1A in relation to ultra-processed foods. And again, I would probably just start by reiterating what I've said in discussion on previous amendments, that this is a framework bill, and the place, again, for this level of detail is in the Good Food Nation plans themselves. And the principles are intentionally high level, and adding in text on a specific issue such as this just wouldn't be appropriate here. And it's also not clear what natural means in relation to food. The word nutritious, which is already in Section 1AC and Section 7AC of the bill as amended at Stage 2, is broad enough to ensure that food is healthy, and the Scottish Ministers and relevant authorities will have to have regard to that when preparing their plans. Ariane Burgess amendments 23 and 33 would replace the word sustainable food production with sustainable food system and supply chain in Section 1AB and 7AB. And I support that amendment, and my view is that if members were to agree to that change, the intention behind Rachel Hamilton's amendment 32 with regard to adding wording about supply chain transparency, sustainability and traceability to Section 7A would be addressed. Monica Lennon's Amendment 67 proposes adding wording to Section 7A in relation to Article 24 of the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. However, the amendment doesn't accurately reflect the wording of Article 24. Article 24 doesn't provide a right to high-quality, nutritious food. The right set out in the article is to the enjoyment of the highest attainable standard of health and to facilities for the treatment of illness and rehabilitation of health. And it goes on to require state parties to pursue implementation of this right and take appropriate measures, including to combat disease and malnutrition through the provision of adequate nutritious foods. So accepting the amendment would place a requirement on relevant authorities to explain in their plan how they would intend to do something that they're presently not under a duty to do. And it's for these reasons that I would urge members not to support the amendment today. So in summary, I would ask members to support amendments 23 and 33 in Ariane Burgess' name and not to support the remainder of the amendments in this.
Thank you. I call Rhoda Grant to wind up and press or withdraw amendment 21.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I intend to press amendment 21. And I'm also happy to support Rachel Hamilton's amendments, given the assurances she provided. I also share her concerns about the Greens' very late amendments, while they accuse others, such as Monica Lennon, of proposing late amendments, they themselves do this. I'm disappointed that the Minister has rejected my amendments. I believe that they would strengthen this bill. And this bill is incredibly timid, and it's quite sad that this government will not take amendments that would make it a much better bill. And that's shown by her rejection of amendments from myself and Monica Lennon, which would enhance people's already human right to food.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. Therefore, the question is that there will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed.
Point of order, Presiding Officer.
Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
Presiding Officer, my app has inquired.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Brian Whittle.
My app hasn't connected. I'd have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Whittle. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, my app's not working. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms. Callaghan. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on Amendment No. 21 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 45, no 64. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment No. 22 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 21. Rhoda Grant to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
You're not agreed.
We are not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My app wouldn't connect, but I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Duncan-Glancy. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 22 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 46, no 62. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 23 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 21. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Move, presiding officer.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment 24 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 21. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. My app froze. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Callaghan. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Neil Bibby.
I had problems with my app. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr Bibby. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, presiding officer. My app has frozen as well. That doesn't seem to be working very well, and I would have voted yes to that.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 24 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 43, no 67. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 25 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 21. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 25 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 43, no 67. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. Members will note that we are nearing the next timeline in order to allow debate on group 6 and 7 under Rule 9.8.5a, I'm minded to accept a motion without notice to propose that the time be extended by 30 minutes. I invite the Cabinet Secretary.
I would move the motion.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The question is that the time limit for debate on amendments be extended by 30 minutes. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We do hope to get this time back. I call Amendment 26 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 21. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. Point of order, Stuart McMillan.
My app didn't connect this time and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. McMillan. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Ruth Maguire.
I would have voted no, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms. Maguire. We'll ensure that's recorded. Did you get that one? That was a no from Ms. Maguire. Point of order, Claire
Hawhey. Presiding Officer, I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms. Hawhey. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 26 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 42, no 68. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 27 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with amendment 21. Rhoda Grant, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Katie Clark.
My app didn't work. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Clark. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 27 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 19, no 65. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 49 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated with amendment 47. Colin Smith, to move or not move?
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 50 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated with Amendment 47. Colin Smith, to move or not move?
Move, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The amendment is agreed to. We We now move on to Group 6, specifying new bodies. I call Amendment 51 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, grouped with Amendments 58 and 62. Rachel Hamilton to move Amendment 51 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I move 51 and the other amendments. My amendments on publishing information about any public authority, the Scottish Ministers intend to specify in regulations under the relevant section and the timescale for making the regulations seeks to encourage greater transparency over Good Food Nation plans. The publication of this information will allow for greater level of scrutiny over the plans and their implementation, particularly in terms of timescales for delivery. Ensuring that relevant authorities and indeed the Scottish Government are held to account over the delivery of the plans are paramount, and to vote against this amendment would undoubtedly suggest an intention to evade accountability over the delivery of the aims of the bill. Amendment 62 in my name seeks to include IJBs, Integrated Joint Boards, as a relevant authority, as supported by the food train. And the inclusion of IJBs as a relevant authority has also been called for by the Scottish Food Coalition, who have been very involved in the process of this bill with all parties. We know the preventative importance of food for health and well-being, so this amendment will ensure social care is explicitly covered, given the lack of statutory requirements on IJBs to produce a food plan. The IJBs will become community health and social care boards and should be required to produce Good Food Nation plans as they oversee the delivery of all community health and social care services and support within their local area, monitoring and improving impact, performance and outcomes for people. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hamilton. Before I move on to the next speaker, abstentions were omitted in the last results and there were 26 on amendment number 27. So for clarity, there were yes 19, no 65, there were 26 abstentions. And I move back to Group 6 and I call on Colin Smith.
Thank you, President Officer. Our integrated joint boards oversee the delivery of community health and social care. Therefore, we very much support their inclusion as a relevant authority in this bill. The provision of good food is absolutely integral to care, to whether it's hospital discharge, food security and home care, crisis care, care at home or residential or nursing care. So Amendment 62 ensures that such joint bodies do not slip through the net and either have to produce their own Good Food Nations plans or that the delegated functions are addressed by the parent authority plans, which is not currently clear in the bill. Our health and social care partnerships produce plans in a whole host of areas relating to care, so it makes no sense for Good Food Nations plans not to be one of those, and they are best placed to lead on plans relating to adult social care. Therefore, Labour very much supports the amendments in this group.
Thank you. I call on the Cabinet Secretary.
In relation to Rachel Hamilton's amendments 51 and 62, a requirement was put in place at stage two by Karen Adams, amendment 59, for consultation before regulations are made to add a new body to the list of relevant authorities. And setting out an intention to do so, as described in Rachel Hamilton's amendments, would be preempting the results of any such consultation. And in addition to that, adding a new relevant authority is also subject to the affirmative procedure, so there would then be an opportunity for scrutiny of the regulations at that point. So this would also apply to Amendment 62, which proposes to add integration joint boards to the list of relevant authorities. And it would be preferable to carry out a consultation, as would be required if, as I hope members agree to pass this bill today, before adding any new relevant authorities. And in addition to that, we of course have the forthcoming National Care Service Scotland bill, which could well likely result in changes to the format and status of the board. So I think their inclusion at this stage would be premature. And for that, those reasons, I would ask members not to support Amendments 51, 58 and 62.
Call on Rachel Hamilton to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 51.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Clearly, I don't agree with what the Cabinet Secretary said. I think that integrated joint boards are an important, relevant authority, and they should hold parity with other relevant authorities within the scope of this bill. I don't believe that we should wait for a preemption of results of consultation, because there are enough stakeholders out there that agree that IJBs are important in terms of the delivery of this bill, and I will press my amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. This will be a 1 minute division. The vote is now closed.
Presiding Officer.
Point of order, Tess White.
Thank you. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms White. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Fulton MacGregor.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. My app lost connection. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr MacGregor. We'll ensure that's recorded.
Presiding Officer.
Point of order, Claire Hawley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Hawhey. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 51 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 45, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 52 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated with amendment 47. Colin Smith to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that amendment 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Move on to Group 7, Healthy Basket Guarantee, and I call Amendment 53 in the name of Rachel Hamilton in a group on its own. Rachel Hamilton to move and speak to Amendment 53.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 53, which I move in my name, would ensure what we call a Healthy Basket Guarantee, and it is considered when good should be considered when good food nation plans are drawn up. The Healthy Basket Guarantee encourages retailers to ensure healthy food items such as fresh fruit and veg remain at affordable prices to encourage healthier eating. Whilst this does not pertain exclusively to public sector bodies, the example that I would give is during the pandemic, which showed there were occasions where food had to be procured by the public sector from the private sector for individuals such as those shielding during the pandemic. And it was widely reported that this food was not nutritionally adequate. A Healthy Basket Guarantee would ensure that if such schemes were to be repeated, which they may do, the most value for money options would always provide a high level of nutritional adequacy for those who have to rely on them. And furthermore, the priorities of this bill have progressed since we started the bill at stage one because they have been exacerbated by the cost of living crisis, and it could provide a deeper understanding of food insecurity. Thank you.
Thank you. I call the Cabinet Secretary.
I'm of the view that this amendment shouldn't be supported. Again, this is a framework bill and the place for this level of details in the Good Food Nation plans themselves. And in addition to that, the term healthy basket guarantee isn't defined. And so it's therefore not clear what the amendment, which would place a legal duty on Scottish ministers, actually requires them to do. So I would urge members not to support this amendment.
Rachel Hamilton to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 53.
Thank you. Once again, the Scottish Government aren't supporting me on what is a proportional measure to ensure that food security is tackled, the cost of living crisis is tackled, and that people have the ability to access fresh fruit and vegetables at affordable prices to encourage healthy eating. But I will be pressing the amendment. Thank you.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed.
Point of order, Presiding Officer.
Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
My app seems to have failed. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 53 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 47, no 61. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. We move on to Group 8, consultation. And I call amendment 54 in the name of Colin Smith, grouped with amendments 55, 55A, 59, 60 and 61. Colin Smith to move amendment 54 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendments 54, 55, 55A, 59, 60 and 61 in my name would require the consultation process undertaken by Scottish Ministers in the development of the National Good Food Nation Plan to be as wide, inclusive and participatory as possible. Amendment 54 specifically would enable participation of those with a range of lived experience of food-related issues. As we discussed in previous amendments, food policy is not just a matter for big private food producers. It impacts on everyone's lives, such as our health, to decent standards in our workplace, from the impact on our environment to animal welfare. Amendment 55 would amend Section 2 of the Bill to add a new subsection requiring Scottish Ministers, when laying a proposed National Good Food Nation Plan before the Scottish Parliament, to also publish a statement summarising the consultation process undertaken, any responses to that consultation and setting how they had regard to those responses in the preparation of the plan. Amendment 55A would require the statement to set out how Scottish Ministers had ensured that that consultation was accessible and inclusive. Amendments 59 and 61 are simply consequential to Amendment 55 and ensure that the provisions relating to the preparation of the plan in the first place would also apply when revising the plan. And Amendment 60 would amend Section 6 of the Bill as amended to remove a reference to the subsections removed by Amendment 52. Given the range of stakeholders with an interest in Good Food Nation plans, it is important that any consultation is comprehensive and inclusive, and these amendments seek to achieve just that. So I'm happy to move Amendment 54 in my name.
I call the Cabinet Secretary.
I'll speak to Amendment 55 first, and because if that's agreed to, as I hope it will be, this amendment would, as Colin Smith has outlined, require Scottish ministers to publish a statement when laying the proposed National Good Food Nation Plan, summarising the consultation process, any responses to it, and then setting out how Section 2.1b of the Bill is amended at Stage 2, and what will become Section 2.3 of the Bill if Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 6 is agreed to, have been complied with. I support Colin Smith's Amendment 55 and the consequential Amendments 59 and 61, and I would also support Amendment 60. Turning now to Amendments 54 and 55A, also in Colin Smith's name, as I set out at Stage 2, I don't support making specific provision about who should be consulted, as the Member has done in his Amendment 54. It's our view that it's not practical to list everyone who should be consulted on the face of the Bill, and the inclusion of a partial list might inadvertently give the impression that those who are listed are of greater importance or should be given greater weight than those who aren't listed. And Amendment 55A would require the statement referred to in Amendment 55 to include information outlining the efforts made to ensure the consultation was accessible and inclusive. And my view is that that's unnecessary because the requirement to consult is already very broad. And in combination with Amendment 6, lodged by Rachel Hamilton, Amendment 55 already requires ministers to set out how they've complied with the requirement to communicate in an inclusive way. I also have concerns that the term accessible as used in Amendment 55A isn't defined. And it's for these reasons that I would urge members not to support Amendments 54 and 55A, but I would encourage members to support the other amendments, 55, 59, 60 and 61 in this group.
Colin Smith to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 54.
President Officer, the consultation undertaken on good food plans by relevant authorities needs to be wide, inclusive and participatory. It needs to enable participation of specific groups such as those vulnerable to food insecurity, people with protected characteristics and those with experience of food-related issues, and that is what these achievements seek to deliver. President Officer, earlier we had a debate over the fact that the government had given private food companies a statutory authority when it comes to the implementation of Good Food Nation's plans, an authority that they will not give to any other stakeholders. And the Cabinet Secretary there has just said we should not single out a particular sector. By failing to support Amendment 54, which seeks the views of those with lived experience, such as those with an interest in fair work, the Cabinet Secretary is doing just that. It is, frankly, hypocritical to say in the implementation we should single out a particular sector, but when it comes to producing those plans, we should not get the views of those with lived experience. So I'm more than happy to move Amendment 54 in my name, because the reality is the failure of the SNP and Greens to support that amendment really does show a lack of priority when it comes to development of Good Food Nation plans.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. vote is now closed. Point of order, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My app wouldn't connect. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kane. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
I'd be grateful if you could check if my vote has been registered, and if not, I would have voted no. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. We'll check. Point of order, Tess White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. White. We'll ensure that's recorded. Mr. McPherson, I confirm that you did vote. Your vote has been recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 54 in the name of Colin Smith is yes 46, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. We now move on to Group 9, which is the importance of communicating in particular ways. I call Amendment 6 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. Rachel Hamilton to move Amendment 6 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move Amendment 6 in my name. Amendments 6, 7, 11, 12, 13 and 43 in my name all aim to ensure that Scottish ministers and relevant authorities have regard to the importance of communicating in an inclusive way. If the Scottish Government wishes to fulfil its ambition to make consultation on the Good Food Nation plans as wide, inclusive and participatory as possible, amendments surrounding inclusive communication should be accepted and welcomed by all parties in the Chamber. The amendments set out that regard must be had to this when consulting on the draft Good Food Nation plans, when publishing any document under Section 1 to 6 and Section 7 to 12, and when consulting on regulations under Section 4, 7, 2, C or 10. Amendment 13 provides a definition of the term communicating in an inclusive way. And, Presiding Officer, would you like me to speak to Section 16, 1A of the Bill?
Yes, please feel free to speak to all members.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Just for clarification, that particular section relates to regulation making powers and requires that before making any regulations under sections 4, 7, 2C or 10, Scottish ministers must consult those as they consider appropriate and have regard to the responses. The purpose and effect of Amendment 43 is to amend Section 16, 1A to provide that when consulting under Section 16, 1A, Scottish ministers must have regard to the importance of communicating in an inclusive way. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Monica Lennon to speak to Amendment 56 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I speak to Amendments 56 and 68, and I welcome the amendments in the name of Rachel Hamilton, and can we will be supporting those amendments. As I said earlier on this afternoon, the rights of children and young people should be at the heart of Scotland's plans to becoming a good food nation. Amendments 56 and 68 would require Scottish ministers and relevant authorities to have regard to the importance of communicating in a way that is effective in engaging children and young people when consulting on their Good Food Nation plans. I previously introduced proposals at Stage 2 that are quite similar to the amendment. Unfortunately, they were not supported at that time. But following further discussion with the Cabinet Secretary, I believe we have reached a position where we can agree on these amendments, and I hope that members will be able to support Amendments 56 and 68 today. These amendments are intended to ensure that consultation in these circumstances is carried out in a way that takes account of the fact that there may be a need to have a different approach to consultation to encourage children and young people to take part. This is intended to help make sure their voices are heard.
Ms Lennon, if I could just stop you for a moment. I'm very aware of various conversations that are taking place across the chamber. I'd be grateful if we could do, Ms Lennon, the courtesy of listening. Please continue.
I really appreciate that, Presiding Officer, because you probably can hear that I'm struggling with my voice today, and we are talking about the importance of communication, which obviously does require good listening skills. So, again, grateful to the STUC and other organisations that have backed these amendments. They were linked to the other amendments that I've spoken about already today, but I think these amendments, together with those set out by Rachel Hamilton, are important and do strengthen the bill, and I move Amendments 56 and 68 in my name.
Thank you, and I call Arianne Burgess to speak to Amendment 40 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to say that I support Rachel Hamilton's amendments that would require Scottish ministers and relevant authorities to have regard to communicating in an inclusive way, as well as Monica Lennon's amendments, which highlight the need to sometimes take a tailored approach to communicate effectively and inclusively with young people. The RAIN Committee report noted that consultations on the Good Food Nation plans should be as inclusive as possible to ensure that the plans draw on a wide range of perspectives, knowledge and experiences. For example, on the lived experience of workers in the food supply chain, who those facing food insecurity or those who have first-hand knowledge of food policies in other countries. I welcome these amendments, which extend this principle of inclusivity to many aspects of the Good Food Nation process through inclusive communication. Amendment 40 in my name provides that the Food Commission, if agreed to, would have to have regard to the importance of communicating in an inclusive way when publishing any documents. This relates to amendments I will speak to later in the debate in relation to the establishment of the Food Commission, that's Group 11. The purpose of Amendment 40 is to provide consistency in relation to the importance of inclusive communication and to embed the importance of inclusive communication in the work of the Food Commission.
Thank you. I call the Cabinet Secretary.
At stage two, I'd asked Rachel Hamilton to work with me prior to stage three to find a workable alternative to the amendments on inclusive communication lodged at stage two. And as I've previously set out, the Scottish Government's approach to consultation will be as open, accessible and inclusive as possible. And I'm really pleased that Rachel Hamilton has worked with me to find wording that's workable in practice. I welcome and support these amendments and also Arianne Burgess related Amendment 40. In relation to Monica Lennon's Amendments 56 and 68, I've had productive discussions with the members since stage two, which have included the importance of consulting children and young people. And I therefore support Amendments 56 and 68 in relation to the importance of communicating in a way that's effective in engaging children and young people.
Thank you. I call on Rachel Hamilton to wind up and to press or withdraw Amendment 6.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I want to thank my colleagues in the Chamber and the Cabinet Secretary for engaging so positively. It is quite amazing what we can do when we work together. And also to Camp Hill, for whom they believe that these amendments are so important. And obviously, all of us here today have agreed with them. And my party will be supporting all the amendments in this group. Thank you. I press. Thank you.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 55 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated with Amendment 54. Colin Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
I call Amendment 55A in the name of Colin Smith, already debated with Amendment 54. Colin Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 55A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
My app hasn't worked. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr Stewart. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Maggie Chapman.
Sir, I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 55A in the name of Colin Smith is yes 44, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. Colin Smith to press or withdraw amendment 55.
Wait, press.
Thank you. And the question is that amendment 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 56 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 6. Monica Lennon, to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 56 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. We move on to Group 10, Review and Report. I call Amendment 57 in the name of Colin Smith, grouped with Amendments 69, 70 and 71. Colin Smith to move Amendment 57 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 57 in my name seeks to ensure that Scottish ministers are required to report on the outcome from the National Good Food Nations Plan and the actions they will take if policies are insufficient to achieve those outcomes. This amendment would mean that there is greater accountability for the Scottish Government in delivering Good Food Nations plans and will ensure that both achievements and any lack of progress can be properly scrutinised by Parliament along with the actions ministers intend to take to remedy any lack of process. I'm therefore happy to move Amendment 57 in my name and grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for working with me on the detail of this amendment.
Thank you. And I call Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 69 and other amendments in the group.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. My Amendment 69 on the procurement of food by local and relevant authorities aims to champion local produce, with rules on local public procurement being strengthened through this bill, and members will notice the words within that amendment 69, which discuss the provenance, particularly the postcode, and ensure that even suppliers who are small suppliers under the under £1,000, which are currently not recorded by local authorities, are able to be part of that process, and also the spend of local and relevant authorities on their food procurement. Authorities should be understanding of where their food comes from, and the local food producers should, where possible, always be preferred to producers from further away. And the environmental argument for this is clear, and I can't see why members wouldn't support this. There is a strong economic case for greater levels of local procurement. The Scottish Government wants to champion a circular economy, and spending local resources on local produce, putting money into local businesses for the benefit of local communities, is a fantastic opportunity within this amendment to do so. And it's absolutely key to unlocking the potential of this bill, making it work for authorities, local businesses, the environment and the people who at the end of the day will be consuming more high-quality, nutritious local produce. And to speak to the other amendment in this group, 71, I refer members to Amendments 62 and 63, and I move the amendment in my name if I hadn't already done so. Thank you.
Thank you. I call the Cabinet Secretary.
At Stage 2, I'd ask Colin Smith to work with me prior to Stage 3 to discuss how to address in the progress reports any areas where outcomes aren't being achieved. And I have had productive discussions with the member on this matter, and I support his Amendment 57 in relation to this issue. Turning now to Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 69, aside from the additional bureaucratic burden that this would place on relevant authorities to record the information required, I also have concerns in relation to the drafting. So, for example, the definition of locally, is this in the local authority area or from within Scotland? And it also leaves questions as to how to deal with food comprised of components which originates in multiple locations. Amendment 70 would require relevant authorities' progress reports to include information on how the relevant authority has ensured that the food it procures has been procured locally and sustainably. And the principles set out in Section 7A of the Bill already require each relevant authority to have regard to the role of sustainable food production and to the fact that each part of the food system and supply chain plays a significant role in the provision of food. What Amendment 70 is aiming to achieve is already covered, meaning that it's not needed. I also have a concern that use of the word ensured in that amendment suggests that there's an obligation on relevant authorities to procure local and sustainable food, and that obligation doesn't currently exist, and adding a requirement for relevant authorities to report on how they've ensured food is produced locally and sustainably wouldn't be an appropriate way to impose such a duty, and it's for those reasons that I don't support Amendments 69 and 70. There are also issues with the wording of the Amendment 71, and similar to those that I mentioned earlier, in relation to Amendment 63 in Rachel Hamilton's name. The first part of the amendment would mean that the progress report, which the relevant authority must prepare by virtue of Section 11 of the Bill, would have to set out how the relevant authority has worked with other relevant authorities in its area to share good practice. And it's not clear what that would mean in practice. So, for example, does its area mean in exactly the same area, areas that overlap with other relevant authorities, or areas that are in close proximity or adjacent to one another? And the second part of the amendment then appears to link the sharing of good practice with a specific outcome in relation to social care, and it's not clear as to the aim of that wording. And aside from the issues with the wording, I would also again reiterate the same point that I've made previously about the framework, this being a framework bill, and the place for detail in relation to the specific outcomes is in the Good Food Nation plans themselves. The progress reports must set out progress being made towards achieving the outcomes in the plans, and so there is already a mechanism by which that will be captured. And the reference to subsection 3B of section 7 should, I think, be a reference to subsection 4A of section 7. And then, in summary, I would ask members to support Colin Smith's Amendment 57, but not to support Rachel Hamilton's Amendments 69, 70 and 71.
Thank you. I call Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was listening with interest to the Cabinet Secretary's response to Rachel Hamilton's amendment, specifically around the amendment which says a proportion of its food is procured from within the local authority within Scotland, within the rest of the United Kingdom. Can I say to the Cabinet Secretary that you can already get that? 5 years ago, I asked all 32 local authorities what they procured and where they procured it from, and they were able to tell me every single item of food that came into the public procurement process. So I don't understand, Cabinet Secretary, why you object to Rachel Hamilton's Amendment 69. Thank you.
Thank you. I call the Cabinet Secretary to respond to that point.
In response to the points that have been raised by Brian Whittle, I believe that I've answered that in the initial comments that I'd outlined in response to in outlining the position on Rachel Hamilton's amendments. First of all, I mentioned the point about the bureaucratic burden, but there's also the issue in relation to the definition of the wording that's used in the amendments too.
Thank you. I call Colin Smith to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 57.
Happy to press Amendment 57 in my name, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 58 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 51. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move. Thank you. The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. The result of the vote on Amendment No. 58 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 44, no 64. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 59 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated, with Amendment 54. Colin Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The amendment is agreed. I call Amendment 60 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated, with Amendment 54. Colin Smith to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 60 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The amendment is agreed. I call Amendment 61 in the name of Colin Smith, already debated, with Amendment 54. Colin Smith to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 61 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. We move on to Group 11, the Scottish Food Commission, and I call Amendment 28 in the name of Ariane Burgess, grouped with the amendments as shown in the groupings. Ariane Burgess to move Amendment 28 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My Amendment 28 to 30 and 44 to 46 propose to add to the bill provisions establishing a Food Commission to provide an oversight and scrutiny role for the delivery of the provisions of the bill. Considerations of the need for a Food Commission is part of the Bute House Agreement and has also been discussed throughout the bill process with a wide range of views expressed. I welcome the Cabinet Secretary's approach to working with members of the committee and others to listen to the views expressed on the preferred approach and to working with me and to deliver our shared commitment to the Bute House Agreement. My amendments 36, 37 and 38 set out provisions in relation to establishment, functions and independence of the Commission. Amendment 39 sets out provisions in relation to the funding and financial assistance that Scottish ministers may provide the Commission. The functions set out in Amendment 37 of the Commission are to, among other things, scrutinise and make recommendations in relation to the Good Food Nation plans and progress reports. Conduct research and provide advice to Scottish ministers and relevant authorities in carrying out their duties under the bill. These provisions aim to capture the range of views expressed as to what the functions of the Commission should be and to provide the necessary oversight that the committee and a wide range of stakeholders want to see included in the bill. Yes.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. Would the member agree with me that it was somewhat disrespectful to the working of the committee that the government's amendment only came forward at the very last minute, which allowed us no scrutiny whatsoever in such an important part of the bill?
Ariane Burgess.
I thank the member for that intervention, and I would say that there's been no disrespect here. There has been a long, ongoing, drawn-out process to try to discover a correct approach for this, and this is what I'm bringing forward today. Amendment 38 sets out that the Commission is not subject to the direction or control of any member of the Scottish Government and is intended to provide the level of independent scrutiny that has been one of the main drivers for establishing a Food Commission. Amendment 39 sets out provisions in relation to funding and financial assistance that may be provided by Scottish ministers. Amendment 46 provides the schedule that sets out the detail with regard to the constitution and operation of the Commission. This includes provisions on the status of the Commission, the powers it has to carry out its functions, details of the procedures associated with the Commission, accountability, the number of members of the Commission, and information relevant to terms and conditions, remuneration, the appointment of staff, the application of legislation relating to public bodies, and the amendments needed as a consequence of setting up the Commission. Amendment 28 and 35 are consequential amendments in relation to the Scottish ministers and relevant authorities having regard to recommendations made by the Commission when reviewing Good Food Nation plans. Amendment 44 and 45 are consequential amendments that are set out that regulations under the section would be introduced by Amendment 37 and under Part 5 of the schedule, as introduced by Amendment 46, are subject to the affirmative procedure. I believe this is appropriate because the regulations concerning the functions and composition of the Commission are of sufficient significance to warrant active parliamentary approval. My amendments set out detailed provisions of the establishment of a statutory Food Commission on the face of the bill and reflect the views of the committee, parliamentary colleagues from across the chamber and those of our partner organisations such as the Scottish Food Coalition. They also represent the accumulation of a commitment contained in the Bute House Agreement to consider the need for a statutory body such as the Food Commission. It is for these reasons that I strongly urge Parliament to accept these amendments. I now turn to Colin Smith's Amendment 37, which amends my Amendment 37A, which amends my Amendment 37 to require that the Commission, when carrying out its functions as described in Amendment 37, must have regard to the principles set out in Section 1A of the Bill. This amendment is not needed, given that the Food Commission has an oversight role. So in carrying out functions such as scrutinising plans and progress reports, having regard to the principles would not be required in order to carry out this function. I ask that Parliament does not support this amendment. Rachel Hamilton's amendments 41 and 42 are identical except for the addition of 6F, which is dependent on her amendment 16 in relation to setting out a purpose of the bill being accepted. Ms Hamilton's amendments set out regulation making powers to establish a Food Commission rather than, as set out in my amendments, the detail of the constitution and operation of a Food Commission. It's for these reasons that I ask Parliament not to support the amendments in Rachel Hamilton's name. In summary, I ask members not to support the amendments in the name of Colin Smith and Rachel Hamilton, and for the reasons I have set out, strongly urge members to accept the amendments in my name to establish a Food Commission, and I move Amendment 28 in my name.
Thank you, Colin Smith, to speak to Amendment 37A and other amendments in the group.
President Officer, the fact Labour supports amendments to establish an independent Scottish Food Commission won't come as a surprise to anyone. It's a key element of my colleague Rhoda Grant's Right to Food Members' Bill and that of Elaine Smith's in the previous Parliament. And myself and Rhoda Grant proposed amendments at Stage 2 of the Bill to deliver such a commission, only for Green and SNP MSPs to vote down that independent Food Commission. Now, I have to say, thanks to the relentless campaigning by members of the Food Coalition, I'm pleased they've forced a U-turn from the Greens and SNP, and they're now backing the establishment of a commission, and we won't see the Greens ditch yet another manifesto commitment in the way they ditched the commitment to enshrine the right to food through the Good Food Nations Bill. However, unfortunately, the failure to do so earlier and the inclusion of such a major element of the bill on the last day for government amendments means there has been no opportunity for any meaningful scrutiny of the detailed proposal, ironically something Arianna Burgess complained about regarding less detailed amendments earlier in the debate. There are parts of Arianna Burgess's amendments which are concerning, for example, the provision for as few as three commissioners, something that has never been proposed by anybody during the consultation on this bill. It's important that the Commission has expertise across the whole food system, and limiting the number of commissioners may restrict its ability to represent all food-related issues. And maybe Ms Burgess can explain in her closing comments why there is a limit on the number of members when we don't, for example, set a limit on the number of members of the Scottish Land Commission. And she could also explain who actually supported this limit at any time during the consultation on this bill. I'm also concerned that the amendment seeks to limit the work of the Commission to that related to the content of Good Food Nations plans, so it's unclear if those plans exclude important matters relating to food policy, the Commission may be limited in how it is able to respond. My amendment 37A seeks to address this concern to an extent and focus the work of the Commission on the principles that inform the preparation of the plans as laid out in subsection 1A and 7A of the bill, irrespective of whether those principles are properly reflected in Good Food Nations plans, reinforcing the importance of these principles. Arianna Burgess says that amendment is not necessary. Well, that's not the view of the Scottish Food Coalition, which makes a mockery of our claim to be listening to stakeholders. I therefore urge members to support my amendment to make sure that the Scottish Food Commission is as effective as possible in providing expert advice and supporting Parliament in its scrutiny of Scotland's progress towards becoming a good food nation.
Thank you. I call Rachel Hamilton to speak to Amendment 41 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Members will be aware of what seems to be some cross-party consensus on the need for an establishment of a Scottish Food Commission to provide oversight and ensure that we get the most from this bill. Amendment 41, which I move in my name, is based on the evidence provided by Dimbleby's important work on the UK National Food Strategy. The Commission would consult a range of stakeholders, from agricultural associations, organisations, to prison boards and everything in between. These stakeholders are best placed to understand what works best for their respective industries and roles within the public, private and third sectors. This will guide the implementation of the Good Food Nation plans and ensure that they deliver for Scotland. Now, we know in the Chamber that the Scottish Government have often been found guilty of marking their own homework. Marine Scotland during the Clyde fisheries fiasco, the OECD assessment of NHS Scotland dealing with poor performance, the SQA's exam chaos. It's absolutely imperative that these mistakes are not repeated with the Scottish Food Commission and that it is allowed to operate truly independently of the Scottish Government. I would add that I understand Ariane Burgess has submitted a similar amendment to this. I am absolutely sympathetic to the aims of this amendment. However, given she represents the party of government, I was disappointed about the manner in which these amendments came about. As I said in my speech in the committee stage two, I was thankful to the Scottish Government for meeting with me to discuss the matter and offering that collegiate approach to the matter of a Scottish Food Commission, among other things. However, the Greens' decision to vote against any amendments relating to the establishment of a Good Food Commission or the office of a commissioner from the Labour and Conservatives was surprising, and Ariane Burgess didn't attempt to approach any opposition members regarding her amendment on this matter. A long, drawn-out approach, as she described it, is just poppycock. It was just that the Greens remained opposed to a commission in stage one and stage two and remained deathly silent, with a lack of transparency, a refusal to seek input from those evidently sympathetic to the aims of the amendment was disappointing and regrettable. And we should be taking every opportunity to work together on this bill that's taken 6 years to come to fruition. We should be taking that approach in all stages where it relates to such common threads and themes that we all agree with in terms of our values. And I hope that going forward, the Greens will think somewhat on their duplicitous approach to amending legislation, particularly given the work that Labour have done on this, on the Labour benches, and also all the people that have been so involved in this, particularly the Scottish Food Coalition, the WWF, and many others. And I will move my amendments 41 and 42 in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I welcome this change of heart by Ariane Burgess and the Cabinet Secretary, who voted against a Food Commission at Stage 2. And while they've tried to clip the wings of the Commission before it gets started, I believe the calibre of the Commissioners will make sure that it works. I agree the process for drafting this amendment was a stitch-up, which I suspected and said as much at Stage 2. And despite the reassurance to the contrary from the Cabinet Secretary, that's simply what happened. Can I put on record my thanks to campaigners, the Scottish Food Coalition, the Co-op Party, Lane Smith and many, many others, whose sustained campaigning has forced the government into this very welcome U-turn?
Thank you, and I call Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. At Stage 2, a number of members proposed amendments to the bill which would see the introduction of a new Scottish Food Commission to provide greater oversight. At that stage, as at Stage 1, the Cabinet Secretary said she wasn't in a position to support the amendments, but the intention was that oversight would be addressed conclusively by the Government by the end of the bill process. And there was, after all, plenty of time to do that before, and for it to come before the committee, before stage two. At that time, I expressed my disappointment at the way in which this process had been handled. The Commission could play a pivotal role in supporting the delivery of the Good Food Nation plans, and is something a substantial volume of stakeholders have called for. The Scottish Government had had ample time when drafting the legislation to consider the inclusion of a Food Commission, but opted not to do so. If the inclusion of a Food Commissioner is integral to the governance of the Good Food Nation plans, then why not include a commission on the face of the bill so that the committee and stakeholders could have properly scrutinised the proposals? It's also hypocritical for Arianne Burgess to criticise others for last-minute Stage 3 amendments when her own amendments should have been scrutinised at the committee stage. This sets a worrying precedent whereby we are presented with framework legislation which contains limited details, using plans defined in secondary legislation to drive policy development. We then have a major addition to the bill announced days before the Stage 3 debate, providing limited scope for scrutiny. Whilst the Cabinet Secretary wrote to the committee to confirm her intention to support a Food Commission, the letter included no information to assist the Parliament's scrutiny of these legislative proposals. It was only after the request for further information that limited details about the costs, functions and status of the Commission, but did not allow proper time for scrutiny of those. No, I won't. This follows the very disappointing and what I consider disrespectful approach that the Scottish Government has taken to this bill, which saw the response to the Stage 1 report not being received until almost 5 weeks after it was published and over a month after the Stage 1 debate. That response, in my opinion, was less than helpful in assisting the committee in its Stage 2 deliberations. I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to reflect on what has been less than satisfactory process followed during this bill.
Thank you. And before I call the Cabinet Secretary, I am aware of a conversation that's been going on in the Chamber for some time, and I would be grateful if it could either be drawn to a close or taken elsewhere. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I mean, I was looking to start this off in a positive tone, because I do think it's a really positive, the amendments that we've seen brought forward today. And I just don't think it's fair either the way that this is being characterised or discussed in the Chamber by some of the members so far. And I think there has been a real mischaracterisation of the process. And Finlay Carson there criticising the government for introducing or for supporting this amendment. But then I think we would have been criticised if we hadn't done so either. And I think that's what's been important about this process, is that we've listened. And that's why we didn't support the amendments at Stage 2. And that was so that I could have these discussions with other members, with other parties across the Chamber, to really get their views, so that we're now in a position where we can support the amendments of Arianne Burgess today. And I really just wanted to thank the members of the Rain Committee and other members who'd met with me to discuss these issues, as well as the stakeholders who've made their views on this known throughout the process. So I think it was important that we did that and we listened to what various members had to say. And as I'd set out in my recent letter to the convener of the Rain Committee, it was important to take the time to consider all the viewpoints relating to oversight. And I have had really productive discussions about the preferred option for oversight of the bill, because, of course, there are also a variety of things that we have to take into consideration, looking at the costs, ensuring that there is that appropriate oversight and scrutiny of the implementation of the Good Food Nation plans. The Scottish Government had also committed, as part of the Bute House Agreement with the Scottish Green Party, to consider the need for a statutory body such as a Food Commission. And I would like to thank Arianne Burgess for working with us to deliver our shared commitment, and I fully support the proposals lodged in her name to set up a statutory Food Commission. Now, setting up the Food Commission as set out in Arianne Burgess' amendments will strengthen the Good Food Nation Bill and provide that further impetus on Scotland's journey to being a Good Food Nation. And I look forward to working closely with other organisations and bodies in the food and drink landscape to achieve that shared goal. Turning to Colin Smith and Rachel Hamilton's amendments, Colin Smith's amendment would require the Commission to have regard to the principles set out in the bill when exercising its functions, but that amendment is unnecessary because the Food Commission has an oversight role. So when, for example, carrying out a function of scrutinising the plans and progress reports, having regard to the principles isn't required or indeed appropriate. And it's for that reason I would urge members not to support Amendment 37A in Colin Smith's name. And Rachel Hamilton's amendments 41 and 42 are almost identical, with the exception of the inclusion of subsection 6F in Amendment 41. And I believe that's to reflect that one is reliant on Amendment 16 in the member's name being agreed to. In both of these options, the amendment would mean the establishment of a Food Commission, with the substantive work of doing so being left to regulation-making power, rather than, as an Ariane Burgess amendment, the detailed provisions for setting up a Food Commission on the face of the bill. The details set out in Ariane Burgess amendments in this group would provide the clarity needed on the functions and structure of the Food Commission, and it's for these reasons that I would ask members not to accept the amendments in Rachel Hamilton's name. And in summary, I welcome and fully support the amendments in Ariane Burgess's name today, and strongly urge members to support her amendments to establish a Food Commission.
Thank you. I call on Ariane Burgess to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 28.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Over months of taking evidence in RAIN committee, we heard why our food system would benefit from fundamental change and why a Food Commission is needed to motivate and support and oversee this transition. After many constructive discussions with the Cabinet Secretary, as she has just outlined, the Scottish Government and the Greens have agreed that an independent Food Commission would be best placed to effectively perform this oversight role to help ensure that good food nation plans really deliver a successful transformation of our food system and supply chains. I'm well aware of the need to be exceptionally careful with public spending at this time due to a range of pressures, including the ongoing constraints on the Scottish Government budget. That's why this amendment sets out the framework for a lean, streamlined commission with a maximum of 4 members plus a chair. It's a similar model to the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and the ability to expand or contract as required. I'm confident that this will be a wise and worthwhile investment which will help local authorities, health boards and the Scottish Government save time and money in the long run and will deliver significant benefits across portfolio areas. I strongly urge members to accept the amendments in my name to establish a Food Commission, and I move Amendment 28.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. Call Amendment... No. Oh, my apologies. I didn't pick up on that. No. We are not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Natalie Dawn.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My app didn't work, but I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms Dawn. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 28 in the name of Ariane Burgess is yes 79, no 1. There were 25 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. I call amendment 7 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 6. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment 62 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 51. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 62 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Siobhan Brown.
It wasn't working and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Brown. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Colette Stevenson.
Had I been able to vote, I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 62 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 45, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 63 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 17. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Move, Presiding Officer.
The question is that amendment 63 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. Point of order, Stuart McMillan.
Connect, and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. We'll ensure that's recorded. Okay. Point of order, Brian Whittle.
Sorry, my app wouldn't connect, and I voted yes.
Thank you, Mr Whittle. We'll ensure that's recorded. That was a yes. Point. Oh, I'll go to Mr McPherson first and then I'll come to you, Mr Gibson. Point of order, Mr McPherson.
They've voted no.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. I'll ensure that is recorded. That was a no from Mr McPherson. Point of order, Kenneth
Thank
Gibson.
Thank you. Again, there was no connection and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. We'll ensure that's recorded. I call Anna Sarwar for a point of order.
Apologies, Presiding Officer. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Sarwar. We'll ensure that's recorded. Result of the vote on amendment number 63 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 46, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 3 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with amendment 17. Brian Whittle to move or not move?
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
I was unable to connect again. I would have voted no.
Could you please repeat that, Mr McPherson?
Unfortunately, I was unable to connect again and I would have voted no if I'd been able to. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Ash Regan.
Sir, my app did not connect. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Regan. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 3 in the name of Brian Whittle is yes 42, no 67. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 29 in the name of Beatrice Wishart, already debated with amendment 17. Beatrice Wishart to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Angus Robertson.
The app didn't connect, Presiding Officer. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr Robertson. We'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Unfortunately, my app didn't connect and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr Fairley. I will ensure that is recorded. And could I just ask members for some silence, because we're finding it difficult to hear up here now. I would be loath to miss anyone's vote. Can I call Ruth Maguire for a point of order?
Presiding Officer, could you just check whether my vote registered? I'm unsure. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Maguire. It hadn't registered, but we'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Michael Matheson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My app didn't work. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr Matheson. We'll ensure that's recorded. I call Natalie Dawn for a point of order.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My app didn't connect. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Ms Dawn. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 29 in the name of Beatrice Wishart is yes 45, no 62. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 64 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with amendment 17. Monica Lennon, to move or not move?
Move.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 64 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
I was unable to connect and would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr McPherson. We'll ensure that is recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 64 in the name of Monica Lennon is yes 46, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 65 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 17. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 65 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 65 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 45, no 62. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment number 66 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 17. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 66 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. Vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 66 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 44, no 62. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 8 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 4. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 8 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 9 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 4. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The amendment is agreed. And I call Amendment 10 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 4. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 30 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with Amendment 21. Rhoda Grant to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I couldn't connect. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kane. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 30 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 45, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 31 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with amendment 21. Rhoda Grant to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. We will move to a division. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. Check. The vote is closed. Point of order, Craig Hoy.
Apologies, Presiding Officer, my app wouldn't refresh. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Hoy. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 31 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 44, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 32 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 21. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move. Thank you. The question is that amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Kenneth Gibson.
Couldn't connect to the system. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 32 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 45, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 33 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 21. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment 34 in the name of Rhoda Grant, already debated with amendment 21. Rhoda Grant to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Kenneth Gibson.
And I could not connect to the digital platform, and I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. We'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Paul O'Kane.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I couldn't connect. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. O'Kane. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, John Swinney.
Basically, I wasn't able to connect to the app, and I would have voted no, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Swinney. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 34 in the name of Rhoda Grant is yes 18, no 62. There were 25 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 67 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with amendment 21. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 67 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. Thank you, Mr. Gibson. I'll ensure that is recorded. The vote is now closed. Point of order, Finlay Carson.
Able to vote, I would have abstained.
Thank you, Mr. Carson. We'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Pam Duncan Glancy.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My vote has recorded no, but I thought I pressed yes. So I don't know that there's a lot that can be done, but I'd just like it on the record that I had hoped to vote yes for the amendment.
Okay. Ms. Duncan Glancy, you are quite correct. There's not a lot that can be done now, but your comment is on the record. Thank you. The result of the vote on amendment number 67 in the name of Monica Lennon is yes 17, no 65. There were 25 abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 11 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 6. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment 68 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with amendment 6. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 68 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendment 69 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 57. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 69 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Ken.
Once again, Gibson. Could not connect to the digital platform. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 69 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 42, no 66. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 70 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 57. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 70 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. Point of order, Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. My voting app failed during that vote. I would have voted.
Can I just ask again, Mr. Mountain, how you would have voted?
Yes, I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Mountain. I'll ensure that's recorded. Colin Smith, point of order.
Thank you, President Officer. I couldn't connect to the app and I would have voted yes if I had done so.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 70 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 44, no 64. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 71 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 57. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 71 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division. Members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Kevin Stewart.
My app has failed, Presiding Officer. I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 71 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 44, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 35 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 28. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order, Ariane Burgess.
Presiding officer, my app didn't work and I didn't vote on my own amendment, but I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms Burgess. We'll ensure that is recorded. Point of order, Ben McPherson.
The connection did not allow me to stipulate the correct vote and I would have voted yes.
Bear with me a moment, Mr McPherson. I can confirm that your vote did register. The result of the vote on amendment number 35 in the name of Ariane Burgess is yes 80, no 1. There were 26 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. I call amendment 12 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 6. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call amendment 36 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 28. Ariane Burgess, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 36 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. Vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 36 in the name of Ariane Burgess is yes 81, no 0. There were no abstentions. My apologies. There were 26 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. I call amendment 37 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 28. Ariane Burgess, to move or not move?
Moved, presiding officer.
I call Amendment 37A in the name of Colin Smith, already debated with Amendment 28. Colin Smith, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 37A be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 37A in the name of Colin Smith is yes 45, no 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call upon Ariane Burgess to press or withdraw Amendment 37.
Press, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. The result of the vote on Amendment number 37 in the name of Ariane Burgess is yes 81, no 0. There were 26 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 38 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with Amendment 28. Ariane Burgess, to move or not move?
Moved, Presiding Officer.
The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 39 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with Amendment 28. Ariane Burgess, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 40 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with Amendment 6. Ariane Burgess, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 41 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 28. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. Point of order.
Sir.
Kenneth Gibson.
Unable to connect to the digital platform, I would have voted no.
Thank you, Mr. Gibson. We'll ensure that's recorded. An additional no. The result of the vote on Amendment number 41 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 42, no 65. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 42 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with Amendment 28. Rachel Hamilton, to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. The vote is closed. The result of the vote on amendment number 42 in the name of Rachel Hamilton is yes 41, no 64. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. I call amendment 13 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 6. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendment 43 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 6. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendment 14 in the name of Rachel Hamilton, already debated with amendment 4. Rachel Hamilton to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendment 44 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 28. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call amendment 45 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 28. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that amendment 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
I call amendment 46 in the name of Ariane Burgess, already debated with amendment 28. Ariane Burgess to move or not move?
Moved, presiding officer.
The question is that amendment 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. There will be a division, and members should cast their votes now. Point of order, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Bibby. We'll ensure that's recorded. Point of order, Colette Stevenson.
My app's froze. Had it been working, I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Ms. Stevenson. We'll ensure that's recorded. The result of the vote on amendment number 46 in the name of Ariane Burgess is yes 80, no 1. There were 26 abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed, and that ends consideration of amendments. As members will be aware at this point in proceedings, I am required under standing orders to decide whether or not, in my view, any provision of the bill relates to a protected subject matter. That is, whether it modifies the electoral system and franchise for Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this bill, in my view, no provision of the Good Food Nation Scotland Bill relates to a protected subject matter. Therefore, the bill does not require a supermajority to be passed at stage 3. There are no questions to be put as a result of today's business. That concludes decision time, and we'll now move on to members' business. And I'd be grateful if members who are doing so could leave the chamber quietly. Thank you.